on, but some things never change. 2,479 and counting for Cal. The number 61 still tantalizingly glitters. Is this the year that Junior or Big Mac eclipses that magical mark? Something old is something new as Milwaukee returns to its National League roots. And baseball is brand new in Arizona and in Tampa Bay. And welcome to opening day 1998, our ninth baseball season here at ESPN. New teams, new yards. The Seattle Mariners will be playing their home games right here by the middle of next summer. Maybe Junior and the guys will be wearing batting helmets just like this. Join Joe Morgan and I as we throw out our first pitch at 7 Eastern time tonight down the street at the Kingdome as Seattle hosts the defending American League champion Cleveland Indians, who in the World Series last year, as Maxwell Smart would say, missed it by that much. Then at 10 Eastern time tonight, it's the D-backs and the Bob. Arizona starts their new era at home against Colorado. Next, though, we go to the forebear of all these new ballparks, Camden Yards in Baltimore, as the Orioles play host to the Kansas City Royals. Let's play ball!
Would you want to be on opening day than right here in Baltimore? Oriole Park at Camden Yards, Boots Barbecue, the Warehouse. In this very short time, this ballpark has established one of the best traditions of the major leagues. The Orioles and Royals will play today. One of the new faces in the Baltimore lineup, Ozzie Guillen, getting to know his new fans. Welcome, everybody, to sold-out Camden Yards. We're here on the last day of March. It is 89 degrees. What a way to get the baseball season underway. And hi, and thanks for joining us. Dan Schulman along with Ray Knight, and we're going to see one of the real powerhouses in baseball today in the Orioles. What's your take on them?
Oh, boy, a great ball club. Outstanding power, team defense, as well as anybody in the game. Starting pitching, great. My question is whether or not Benitez is going to be able to replace Randy Myers, and that bullpen may be the focus on this ball club all year long.
And with a $74 million payroll, that'll be another focus, and 14 free agents, the Orioles better win this year. Their opposition today, the Kansas City Royals, one of the small market teams in baseball. They're going to send Tim Belcher to the mound as the Royals try to rebuild and move back up the ladder in the American League Central. Come on back and join us. First pitch is mere moments away from Camden Yards in Baltimore.
ESPN's opening day special is brought to you by the nice people at Red Roof Inns, over 260 locations nationwide, offering honest value every day. By Ricoh, the number one maker of digital copiers in America. By Aquafresh Whitening, safe to use every day for dazzling whiter teeth. And by Turtle Wax, the world's leader in car care.
This is a flat tire, and so is this. Goodyear AquaSteel Run Flat. Even with no air pressure, you can drive up to 50 miles to safety. New AquaSteel Run Flat, only from Goodyear.
Goodyear, Goodyear.
Who always greets you warmly and asks a little in return? The folks at Red Roof Inns. A genuine smile, a clean, comfortable room, and a great rate. Dogs have no concept of money, no pockets. Red Roof Inns, nice people, and an honest value.
Hi there. America loves the new digital imaging from Ricoh. The Officio line. So fast, reliable, colorful, user-friendly. Hi, how you doing? Connectable. Copiers, fax, multifunction solutions with crisp reproduction. Color manipulation. Or just gorgeous black and white. Totally digital. Officio. By Ricoh. Wow.
A whitening toothpaste that really works and has all the fluoride I need each day.
Aquafresh Whitening gives you all the fluoride of Crest cavity protection, but whitens better. And Aquafresh is safe to use every day.
Look, what makes Aquafresh Whitening so special?
Aquafresh's patented tri-clean formula gently breaks up stains to help get teeth their whitest. Not even Rembrandt whitens better.
In that case, count me in.
Aquafresh Whitening, safe to use every day for dazzling whiter teeth.
Yeah! It's the number one ranked minivan by car and driver. Montana from Pontiac. The rugged minivan with seating for eight.
Pick you boys up same time tomorrow.
Life is more exciting in Montana by Pontiac.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to opening day here on ESPN. Gary Miller with you in the studio throughout the day. We've got a triple header for you. We'll get you out to Camden Yards shortly where it's around 90 degrees. But the first game of the day was in Shea Stadium. Imagine on March 31st, a day in the upper 80s. New black hats for the Mets, and with good purpose. Fans were ditching school and work and watching Bobby Jones work over Doug Glanville, the new leadoff man and center fielder for the Phillies. Glanville eventually worked the count and then grounded out to Ray Ordonez, the first out of the year. Kurt Schilling, a Mets nemesis, coming in with high heat to get Edgardo Alfonso. And then Bernard Gilkey, who finished the season last year strong, started out poorly, starts this one out badly. Schilling with the strikeout to end the first. We go to the second. Bobby Jones to the Phil's new second baseman, Mark Lewis, with a sharp single, has the first hit of 1998. Jones put two on, then faces Desi Relaford, the man replacing Kevin Stockner, and the big bender gets him. And it's a pitcher's duel at Shea. We've gone to the sixth, still scoreless. Schilling, who won 17 games a year ago and struck out over 300 batters against Bobby Jones, who had 15 wins last year. They are both scoreless. Padres and Reds. Cincinnati has fallen completely apart. Remember, Barry Larkin will be out at least another month with his injury. So Pokey Reese has taken over at shortstop. He's already made four errors in this game. Padres up 3-0, and with Kevin Brown on the mound, looks like the Padres are off to a good start for 1998. American League underway at Arlington. Texas and Chicago, two offensive clubs. But right now, Jamie Navarro and John Burkett, both nine-game winners a year ago. Navarro lost 14, Burkett 12. They're scoreless in the third. Later today, we'll take it to the Indians and the Mariners. That's Randy Johnson open up against Charles Nagy. Then Daryl Kyle against Andy Benes in the very first ever game for the Arizona Diamondbacks. We keep going. We got five games in 36 hours. The Giants and Astros, you can see Hershiser's debut. Yankees and Angels are late game tomorrow. But right now, it's time for opening day. We go back to Camden Yards. Dan Schulman.
Gary, thank you very much. And you could not ask for a better afternoon to kick off the baseball season. What a difference between this year and last year. Remember all the games on the East Coast and the Midwest that were frozen out in the first week or so. No danger of that. 30 degrees above the average temperature here for March 31st in Baltimore. Just a beautiful afternoon to get the regular season underway. Well, the Baltimore Orioles getting a ton of attention for their ability, but also for their payroll and for their age. They are by far the oldest team in Major League Baseball. But to Ray Miller, their manager, that's not such a big deal.
As far as the age of the ball club, one of the writers here used the term Jurassic Park, like coming to Jurassic Park. And Elrod Hendricks had a great line. He said, if I'm not mistaken, that was a box office hit. And at the end, the only thing left was the dinosaurs because they ate everything in sight.
Well, Ray Knight, Ray Miller makes an interesting point. He says the age is not a problem.
Well, it's not. I think these ball players nowadays have gotten really well conditioned. Cal Ripken obviously leads that charge with his tremendous work ethic. And all you have to do is look at them, the way they prepare in batting practice. They all take a lot of ground balls. And somebody that's 35 that takes care of themselves can play like a 30-year-old, as Eric Davis has done the last couple of years.
The bigger issue may be all the free agents, but that's something to worry about a little bit later on in the season. Right now, Eric Davis and company trying to defend their American League East Division title and try to advance beyond the American League Championship Series, which is where they've been stopped the last couple of years. And to help them do that, they've picked up Joe Carter, Ozzie Guillen, Doug Drabek, Norm Charlton, all guys who have been around and been through the wars before.
Well, you talk about experience and age. When you have been through the wars and you go out there and you play this game, you learn all the small things that enable you to win, and then you're able to get the players at the back end of the careers like Ozzie Guillen and Joe Carter to be a part of the club that already has a great nucleus. That generally leads to championship.
The Orioles have taken the field in front of the sellout crowd here at Camden Yards. Time to look at the starting lineup for the visiting Kansas City Royals, brought to you by Pontiac. This is a young team. They lost Jay Bell. They lost Chili Davis.
in the offseason. They picked up a couple of veterans, though. One of them, Terry Pendleton, not expected to be a starter, but with an injury to Jeff Conine, it has forced Pendleton into the starting lineup. As you can see, he's been around. He's won an MVP. He's been in five World Series, and he's hoping to bring a little bit of a winning attitude to the Kansas City Royals.
Well, Terry Pendleton is an outstanding acquisition. You're going to see Mike Mussina today, our starter. He's 15-8 last year. 6.682 win percentage, which is sixth best all time. This man has a tremendous repertoire. Fastball, 95 miles an hour, two-seamer that he can run into the right-handed hitters. Knuckle curveball that sometimes he backdoors to left-handed hitters. And then an outstanding circle changeup. Moves the ball around in the strike zone. One of the true power pitchers and best control pitchers in the game.
Defensively for the Orioles, it's the same group as last year, assuming that everybody is healthy. And the guy we'd like to focus on a little bit out in right field, Eric Davis. One of the very best people and one of the very best players in the game. And I know for you specifically, having managed him and knowing him very well, it's inspiring here in 98 just to think about what he went through in 97.
Well, I have great affection for him even before he was riddled with the cancer. Came to our ball club, had not played because of a neck injury, and earned himself a position on the ball club. I thought as a fourth outfielder. Opening day, he was my leadoff hitter, and before the year was over, he was hitting fourth and was the best player on my club that year. I have a great affinity for him, affection for him, and a tremendous respect for his, not only his baseball ability, but his heart.
And you have to respect the baseball ability of Mike Mussina, who took his game to another level in the postseason last year for the Orioles. First batter of the season here in Baltimore will be Kansas City center fielder Johnny Damon. And on the corner for strike one. Better than 45,000. Love that here at Camden Yards.
Well, you're going to see a lot of that. Mike Mussina has gotten a reputation as being a hard thrower, but he has tremendous command of all four of his pitches.
Damon in his third year with the Royals, now looking at an 0-2 count. He was expected to do some huge things. Had a monster season at AA a couple of years ago and has become a good young center fielder, but has yet to reach the stardom that was predicted of him.
Well, they talked about him hitting 20 home runs and stealing 50 bases, and he's a long way from doing that.
And Mussina wasting no time at all.
Well, what Mussina did here is he started away, and he moved out Hoyles all the way off the strike, all the way off the plate. Four ball, that ball's 4 inches outside, and he has no chance.
Doesn't look like Mike Mussina is rusty at all. Had a pretty good spring. Didn't get the opening day start for the Orioles a year ago because of a bad elbow, but this is his fourth career opening day start for Baltimore. This is Jose Offerman, second baseman for the Royals. Oh, and Mussina just living on the outside part of the plate.
And Danny, what he'll do, he and Hoyles will work so well. Hoyles will continue to move out until they find out what the umpire is going to call a ball. Then they'll move it back in, but they've already moved off the plate about 5 inches.
Breaking ball fouled off, 0-2, five pitches and five strikes so far.
And all you young pitchers at home, you see, he started off with four straight fastballs. That's something that I see a lot of the young pitchers doing nowadays, working on breaking balls, split fingers. The key to pitching in the big leagues is establishing that fastball, locating it, and then going to breaking balls.
Now he's got Offerman in a hole. Hoyles moves outside, and the fastball misses. Trade rumors involving Jose Offerman. Kansas City apparently looking for some pitching. Kevin Apier's out for 3 months. And they've got a good young prospect in Jed Hansen, who right now is on the team as a utility player. And McKean is unquestionably giving Mike Mussina the outside corner and then some.
There's been a lot of talk about umpiring the last couple of 3 years. You look how far Hoyles has set outside. That ball's on his left shin guard. Finishes up about 8 or 9 inches away. Probably with the run of the fastball, maybe missing the plate by 3 inches. But when a guy can put it there consistently like Mussina and Greg Maddux, they get the call.
There's been a lot of talk about speeding up the game and helping out the pitchers. Would you like to see a bigger strike zone like we're seeing today?
No.
You're a hitter.
I just believe in that plate's there for a reason.
Yep. There's Hal Morris. Morris coming over from Cincinnati. He's playing left field today with Jeff Conine on the DL. Expect to see him more often than not as a designated hitter.
He better get that beard off.
fastball fouled off, 1-1. Not a great year for Morris last year, just 276. But a career 305 hitter, almost won a batting title. You had him as well. This guy can swing the bat.
Well, he can flat out hit. He hurt his shoulder last year and played about 70, 80 games with a bad shoulder. He's really a gamer, one of the top 10 hitters for average in all the game, in my mind. Can drive the ball, a lot more power than people give him credit for.
And a ground ball out to second. Over to Alomar. Will make the play. And a very tidy 1-2-3 inning with a couple of strikeouts for Mike Mussina. Orioles coming up against Tim Belcher after this.
Total Wax,
Some people say clear coat cars don't need wax. Clear coat's thinner than the piece of paper. So, what protects the clear coat?
New Turtle Wax Emerald Series Car Wax.
Waxing with Emerald Series puts down four times the Carnauba wax as the number one brand. With no powdery residue.
Do your best wax job ever with the best wax you can buy. Turtle Wax Emerald Series.
Emerald Series is the best hard shell finish.
Turtle Wax.
He was a top undercover agent.
A nine-year-old kid cracked the government's supercode.
Until he went too deep.
This is way over our heads, and I
saw too much.
It's not a murder-suicide. They're trying to get the kid.
And went too far. Critics are calling Mercury Rising a first-rate action-packed thriller. Bruce Willis at his best.
Get down!
Mercury Rising. Rated R. Starts Friday at theaters everywhere.
And welcome back to Baltimore. Very good inning for Mike Mussina. Three up and three down. Now the Orioles coming up against Tim Belcher of the Kansas City Royals. Let's get a look at that Baltimore Oriole lineup. Presented by Pontiac, and you won't find more of a star-studded group around a baseball. Just about everybody in this group has been an all-star before. There's one new face. He's DHing today and hitting seventh. Joe Carter, after 7 years in Toronto, comes to Baltimore. One of the more consistent run producers in the game, trying to get back to the World Series one more time, and feeling Baltimore is about as good a shot as he's got to get to postseason play. And you can't argue with that logic. He's also in the lineup today over Harold Baines, Ray, because he hits Tim Belcher awfully well.
He surely does. Harold Baines, 185 off of Belcher, and Carter, 321. Timmy Belcher, you see there, 242 hits and 213 innings. Features a fastball about 91, 92. Likes to throw a cutter. His cutter is really his out pitch, which is just a fastball off-centered that moves about 3 or 4 inches and gets on the end of hitters' bats. Throws a slurve and a straight changeup.
Defensively for the Kansas City Royals, a number of new faces. We're going to highlight the shortstop, Felix Martinez, taking over for the departed Jay Bell. Martinez, they tell us, could make the spectacular play, but as you can see from the 36 errors, he will often blow the routine play. And he committed 9 errors in spring training, so we'll keep an eye on that, as will Tony Muser, his manager. And leading off for the Orioles, their center fielder, Brady Anderson. Anderson, just a few days ago, chipped a bone in his hand, tried to steal second. He was hit by a throw from Florida catcher Charles Johnson, and they weren't really sure if he was going to be ready to start the season. But how many times have we said that about Brady Anderson? And he's always in the lineup.
Well, you'll see the difference in umpiring with pitchers. Belcher will have to establish the strike zone, his strike zone, the ability to throw the ball to a certain spot, and then McKeon will go out there with him. If he doesn't establish that, he won't get those pitches that Mussina was getting.
Mussina, I think, after two pitches had established
he
the
had
outside
it.
Corner because he kept hitting it.
He may have established it after last year's season.
Tony Muser, with his first opening day managerial assignment with the Royals, took over for Bob Boone at the All-Star break last year. He knows he's got an uphill battle ahead of him with his team this year. One ball, two strikes on Anderson. And a little bit up and in to even it up.
Back to Tony Muser. I've known Tony for quite a long time, played against him in the minor leagues, and he believes in having one agenda, and that's what's happened so often in the big leagues. You have four or five players that have different agendas.
Belcher takes something off and strikes out Anderson to begin the first.
And then it becomes a real problem. So his whole idea and his direction is we've got one agenda. It's my agenda. We're all going to follow it. So hopefully it'll work for him.
That's the Marine background in Tony Muser. He's pretty regimented guy. Number two batter, another guy trying to stay healthy, Roberto Alomar, a career-high batting average last year, as you can see, despite a bad left shoulder that prevented him from hitting right-handed most of the season. But he can swing the bat both ways here to begin 98. Fastball strike, it's 1-1.
That's that BP fastball that the Orioles teach, 82 miles an hour. Belcher used to be a power pitcher with the Dodgers, then with the Reds. As I said on the onset, through 91, 92, now is down around 86, 87, more finesse.
And again, just getting the start here today because Kevin Apier is out for at least 3 months after shoulder surgery. Going to be a big roar when Eric Davis makes his way to the plate after Alomar's turn. Fans didn't know who to cheer for the loudest when the Orioles came out in the pregame introductions, whether it be Ripken, Alomar, Palmeiro, gave Joe Carter a nice warm welcome, but maybe Eric Davis got a little more than everybody else. The 2-2 to Alomar.
When we talk about finesse pitchers, as you look in the Oriole dugout there, Ray Miller, he knows a lot about finesse pitching. Mm-hmm. They have a tendency to take off and add to the fastball. I've seen fastballs now 88, 86, and 81.
Knocked down at first, and Belcher covering on the toss from Jeff King to retire Alomar, two down. These Kansas City Royals, they have turned it over a little bit more out of necessity than out of desire. They lost Jay Bell and Shelly Davis, two of their three best power hitters from a year ago. They went out and got a couple of guys, probably won't duplicate the power numbers, but will hit for a nice average, and Jeff Conine and Hal Morris. And Conine could be back in about 10 days.
Well, I really like Jeff Conine, and certainly with Shelly Davis leaving and Jay Bell, talking about two outstanding offensive players, but Conine and Morris don't have to take the backseat to anybody when it comes swinging a bat.
Here's Eric Davis, his first at bat of the season. You know very well the story by now, diagnosed with colon cancer midway through last year, left the team for a few months, came back, and while undergoing chemotherapy, rejoined the club in September and had an impact down the stretch. And now, cancer-free here to begin 1998.
Well, praise the Lord. I tell you, a lot of prayers were out for Eric last year. And talking about a true warrior, there he is, ladies and gentlemen, going through what he's gone through. And he had a terrible problem with his neck. He could hardly move his neck back about 3 years ago to cause his early retirement.
And Ray Miller says ideally he wants to play Davis about 100 to 110 games. They don't want him out there every day. So when he comes out, that's when you'll see a Jeffrey Hammonds or a Joe Carter. And apparently even Harold Baines has a glove this year. He might even play a little outfield.
Well, he's effective when he plays 4 days a week. When I was in Cincinnati and had him, tried to play more than that, he wears down. He's got a real lithe, great body, but he just tends to wear down. So he's a lot better off playing 4 days a week.
Down and away, 2-2. And the Orioles with a luxury to have a Hammonds and a Baines or a Carter on the bench. Nobody else in baseball has those kind of players.
No, we were talking about that. I think they have as good a bench as there is in all of baseball.
Belcher working quickly. Two down, nobody on. And Davis grounds one foul left side.
One thing that Eric Davis did in his career that a lot of people have not been able to do, you could throw the fastball by Eric Davis belt high and up. He could not get to the fastball early in his career. Basically, ran him out of the league and he got him over the American League. And then he came back and he learned to hit that ball belt high and he started hitting it to right center field and stopped being such a pull hitter. Became really dangerous.
When he first came up, he looked like the next Willie Mays. He just did everything as well as you could do it.
I remember I was with Detroit and we were playing. Pete Rose was managing Eric Davis in spring training in Lakeland. And he had two bombs against the win over there at Lakeland and Joaquin Marchant Stadium. And I had not seen anybody come along since Cesar Cedeno. It reminded me of the type of player of a Willie Mays on Aaron.
Down and away, and it's full to Davis. He had an 80 stolen base season. This guy knows a little bit about some career and accomplishments. The new bench coach for the Baltimore Orioles, Eddie Murray. I can always activate him, send him up for a pinch hit or two, maybe. And a swing and a miss, and Davis is gone. Belcher battling Davis and beating him, and like Mussina, strikes out two in the first inning.
National Outdoors for the largest selection of military-style clothing and equipment in town. Metal GI bunk beds, $179.98 a set. Assorted military-style blankets, $9.98 and up. Military ammo cans, $8.98. Canvas tool bags, $16.98. Duffel bags galore, just $19.98. Rain ponchos, $4.98 and up. Canvas and poly tarps in all sizes. Paintball guns, $39.98 and up. Cabin tents, only $49.98 and up. And camouflage clothing for adults and children.
At National Outdoors, your adventure starts here.
This is CNN, the world's news leader. For two decades, cable's coverage of breaking events have made CNN the network the world watches. CNN covers history in the making. That's why more people turn to cable for live, believable, and balanced news coverage 24 hours a day. Another reason why CNN is America's favorite network for news.
Satisfaction, America.
Cash. Thousands of families have turned to J.G. Wentworth for money for medical expenses, business opportunities, debt consolidation, and new homes. If you're receiving periodic payments from a structured settlement or personal injury award and need cash, call now. Once again, if you're receiving structured settlement payments over a long period of time but need cash, call now. Call 1-800-603-0608.
Welcome back to Baltimore. Mussina and Belcher both very effective in the first inning, each with a couple of strikeouts. Mike Mussina, very effective. That sums up the way he has been his entire career. One of the most effective pitchers, wins as often as any active pitcher. And among all-time pitchers, his winning percentage is right up there among the leaders. He hasn't won 20 games in a season yet, but as you can see, fourth all-time in a winning percentage, and just figures to get better. He's only now entering his prime.
He knows how to pitch, and he's got a lot to pitch with.
A very smart pitcher, came out of Stanford. Six different pitches and really took his game to another level in the postseason last year against both Seattle and Cleveland. Here's Jeff King, the cleanup hitter, the first baseman for the Royals, to lead off the second. Average high power kind of year for Jeff King.
Dead red fastball hitter in the National League the last couple years he was over there. You could not throw a fastball by this man. You can get him out with breaking balls, but you better not fool with him with a fastball.
Base hit into left, and we'll get our first base runner either way of the afternoon. What's your take on career National Leaguers who come over? Pittsburgh dumped everybody, and some, like Bell, had excellent years, and some, like Carlos Garcia, had dismal years. Is there a way of adjusting quickly?
Well, I think probably 15 years ago, maybe 10 years ago, there was such a difference in the pitching, and now there's so many people changing ball clubs that there's not much difference. And the scouting and the advanced scouting, you pretty much have seen these guys either in spring training or somewhere along the line. So there's not much of an adjustment anymore.
And here's a guy who has certainly been around, Terry Pendleton. Spent last year with Cincinnati, DHing and hitting fifth for the Royals this afternoon. And King is a threat to steal at first base.
He surely is. He's a lot like Johnny Bench was. He'll get a walking lead and keep increasing that lead, and then try to guess breaking ball or split finger and take off on you and steal 75% of the bases that he attempts.
And Pendleton, another one of these career National Leaguers, just now making his debut in the American League after all these years in baseball. Started off with St. Louis, had his best year in 1991. With Atlanta, another outstanding year in 1992. Wound up in Florida, back to Atlanta, and then a little bit with Cincinnati last year. A lot of people thought maybe we would see the last of Terry Pendleton, but the Royals happy to pick him up, especially having lost a couple of their key players from last year.
Well, Terry was always hurt. Last year he came to spring training coming off of orthoscopic knee surgery, and consummate professional. I hated not being able to play him because he wanted to play so badly, but when he'd go out and play a special on AstroTurf, his knees would ache and he would miss a day or two. He finally DL'd him, then he hurt his toe. I didn't think he was finished. I thought that he's always been a little chunky, and then when he got a little older, his legs started giving him trouble.
1-1 the count, King the lead, not going. And apparently here in Kansas City, it's unlikely if Pendleton will actually play defense. He'll be used as a DH and a pinch hitter. They've got Dean Palmer down at third base, so they're well taken care of there.
Well, he's one of those consummate professionals, as I said, that knows how to hit behind the runner, get a good ball to hit. He never makes a mistake, whether it is defensively, base running, hitting and running, bunting. He just always seems to do the right thing.
One ball, two strikes. Leadoff man aboard for Kansas City here in the second.
And as really a first-year manager for Mussina, he managed part of last year, going into a season, it's important to have those type of players that will keep the clubhouse rectified, that will keep the clubhouse going in that direction that he's talking about. Terry Pendleton is one of those type people that will do that for him. Very vocal in the clubhouse, not afraid to get on people in a quiet way.
Now back. Well, they lost in Jay Bell. They lost one of the real quality citizens in baseball, and Chili Davis, too, a guy who's been around a long time and one of these walks softly, carry a big stick kind of guys. So they're looking for a little bit of leadership. A lot of baby faces over in the Kansas City side of the field, aren't there?
I recognize Jeff Conine in that bunch.
Pendleton battling Mussina, 1-2. And he drives it to left field, deep. Surhoff going back. It's over his head and off the track. King on his way to third, and Terry Pendleton with a terrific at-bat, 2 in scoring position for Kansas City.
One thing you have to do about big league hitters as they get older, you got to get the ball close to them. That ball's out away from him. Easy to get the bat barrel on the ball. Terry, with two strikes, looking for a pitch that he can handle. You got to crowd older hitters in. It takes them a long time to get the bat barrel out there. You're doing them a favor when you go away with it.
And Pendleton taking advantage, doubling to left field. Second and third, nobody out. And Dean Palmer, the Kansas City third baseman, is up. Familiar hesitation by Mussina with runners on and now ready to work. Palmer up there swinging, fouls it off. Kansas City acquiring Palmer from Texas in the middle of last season. Those are his combined numbers between the two teams. And he became a free agent at the end of the year, but after talking to the Indians and the Red Sox, settled back in Kansas City again.
I saw this man in spring training about 5 years ago, and I thought he was going to be a Matty Williams type. He did hit 38 home runs that one year, I guess in 95. But I thought he was going to be a 30 home run year guy every year. Tremendous power, swings hard all the time.
As a hitter, when you suffer an injury like the one he did, he ruptured his bicep tendon, an unusual and a terrible injury. Is that always in the back of your mind?
Well, if it hurts you, it does. If there's muscle still scarring, it does. But I think with the hard work that he has, I saw him around the batting cage. He's really pumped. His arms are strong. The big thing you try to do now is prevent that type of injury again. So you work extra hard. And, once something heals, you don't worry about it anymore.
Ball and a strike, and Palmer a chance to drive in a run or two. The Orioles infield is back. They'll give up a run on a ground ball here early in the game. And ground ball to third. Ripken will go across the infield to retire Palmer. Pendleton holds, but King scores, and the Royals lead 1-0.
Mussina made a real good pitch there on Palmer, ran the fastball in on him, jammed him, sawed his bat off, ball wasn't hit hard enough for Cal to come to the plate.
So a runner at second and one down with the Royals jumping on top. Mussina now readying himself to face the right fielder, Larry Sutton. Not such a young guy, but a new guy, 27 years of age, just got a taste of the major leagues last September with the Royals. And because of some injuries, has moved from first base, his natural position, out to right field. Jermaine Dye just didn't have a good spring, a bad quadriceps. He was sent down. And they needed another outfielder. And Sutton, a left-handed hitter with some very good minor league numbers, happy to get the playing time. Well, he slides away. And there's the call McKean's been giving him.
He's going to get it all day long. Once he's established it, he's not going to change it. Watch the catcher set up outside here. He's set up with his ball, with the ball right there, and then he reaches and catches it on his left knee. There's no way that ball is a strike, but it's just he's established that as his strike zone, and anything near that outside corner of the plate, he's going to give to Mussina.
And now Sutton's going to have to protect the plate and a few inches off the plate with an 0-2 count. It's got to be the first thing a hitter will come back to the dugout and tell other guys about. Got to watch the corner. He's giving it to him.
Well, they know that a guy with Messina's stature is going to get those pitches anyway, so they better come into the game taking that couple of inches on the outside part of the plate and trying to do something with it.
Mussina ahead 0-2. Pendleton out at second. And the breaking ball is grounded down to first. Palmeiro makes the play unassisted. Two down. Let's go to Gary Miller in the studio.
All right, thanks a lot, Dan. Of course, you know, opening day is a day of firsts, so let's give you the first home run of 1998. It happened in the first game, the traditional opener at Cincinnati. That's Wally Joyner going deep off David Weathers, who had just come in relief of Mike Remlinger. That was a solo shot in the sixth. And Robin Ventura with Albert Bell aboard off John Burkett. Over Goodwin, a two-run shot. White Sox up 2-0 in the fifth.
A couple of home runs already, and Mike Remlinger started for Cincinnati, Ray, only because Dave Burba was traded yesterday, just one day before he was to get the opening day start for the Reds.
Yeah, those trades usually are made sometimes in August, aren't they?
Going to Cleveland for a young first baseman, Sean Casey. The batter, Mike Sweeney, the catcher for the Royals, pops it out of play. Kansas City has taken the lead here at Baltimore. Base hit by King, a double by Pendleton, and then an RBI ground out by Palmer. Now two down. And Sweeney, the batter, he's expected to get most of the playing time behind the play with Mike McFarlane assuming the role of backup. Sweeney just not willing to give in to anybody at all, making all these hitters reach for everything.
Well, that was a little slider there, a little cut fastball, 78 miles an hour. What Mike has done early is establish his fastball. It was a fastball that Pendleton hit out there off the wall in the left field. And then he tends to go to the breaking ball the second time around the lineup. He's going to the breaking ball a little bit earlier because he's been in trouble this whole inning.
Again, ahead on a hitter, 0-2. Can he put away Sweeney and finish the inning? Muscled up on that fastball a little bit and missed outside. Pendleton's hit the key to the inning. He's down at third now with two outs. And the 1-2. Mussina in the offseason wanted the Orioles to sign a new contract. Three-year deal that he admits is below market value, but says he wanted to stay here in Baltimore. Outstanding control as always. He can't do it much better than that. 22 strikes and 27 pitches. And time called at the plate by Sweeney. And Sweeney gets much more deliberate whenever there's a runner on base. The 1-2. Just a bit inside, and it's two balls and two strikes.
Well, this has been a strike to a left-hander all day long, and they're right-handed. He's looking right at it and won't ring him up. You see that a lot. You see the umpires giving the outside part of the plate a lot more often than they give the inside part of the plate. They call the inside part of the plate pretty true.
Now 2-2. And down and away, and it's full. Mussina having to work a lot harder here in the second than he did in the first when he needed only 10 pitches. Should Sweeney reach, the young shortstop Felix Martinez would get his first at bat of the season.
Well, he won't give in to him here with the number 9 hole hitter behind him. He's going to make a pitch somewhere.
Got him. Third strikeout of the afternoon for Mussina, but the Royals take the lead. King, Pendleton, and Palmer combining. A 1-0 Kansas City lead off one of the very best of the game. Mike Mussina here on opening day for the Baltimore Orioles.
Guys like, whoa, guys like me don't get much respect. I mean, I hit big, but there's no D-word commercial. I make huge plays. I'm not even in a cereal box. But man, I could care less.
Triple Play 99. You've never seen baseball like this.
Who needs cereal?
Whoa. EA Sports. It's in the game.
Tired of carrying all that heavy water around every time you vacuum the wet basement? ShopVac QPV, the quiet vacuum that sucks water from one place and pumps it to another. Because you've got better things to do than lug water around. ShopVac, the only thing more powerful is our name.
When you've lived 7 or 8 lives, you can make some pretty long-lasting friendships. But even when you've known someone forever...
You take a check.
Of course, I'll take your check.
Can I see some ID, please?
Without ID, you're history. Use the Visa check card. It's an ATM card that deducts directly from your checking account everywhere Visa's accepted. Works like a check, only better.
By the way, Caesar liked me better.
I like being in control. With this Dinner-X, I control the cause of my dandruff every day.
Dinner-X Advanced Formulas Medicine doesn't just treat the symptoms. It controls a leading cause of dandruff called P.O. Valley.
Now that's serious control.
Dinner-X Advanced Formula.
After last year's early elimination, Team USA is back with a vengeance. Andre Agassi leads the U.S. team against Kafelnikov and the Russians in the first round of the Davis Cup. Singles action begins Friday at 1, only on ESPN.
Last season, the Baltimore Orioles led the Eastern Division wire to wire, winning 98 games, got as far as the American League Championship Series, and decided to go out and make a couple of moves in the offseason. They lost Randy Myers. The bullpen's a very different story. Look at the 4 veterans they picked up in Carter, Guillen, Drabek, and Charlton. All 4 have been around. You've got the contrast in a guy like Carter, who's hit a World Series winning home run, and then a guy like Ozzie Guillen, who has played more games than any other active player without getting to a World Series. So,
well, Pat Gillick knows a little bit about putting a ball club together, and he and Kevin Malone, the assistant GM, have done a tremendous job here. Ray Miller obviously knows pitching. Had Doug Drabek over there in the great years with the Pirates when Drabek was there. And he's really pumped up about being able to work with Doug Drabek again and looking for a guy that's going to go out there and give him 200-plus innings.
There's Rafael Palmeiro, first baseman and cleanup hitter for the Orioles, a 1-1 count. Palmeiro yanks one into right field, and that's a solid base hit to get the Orioles started here in the second.
Well, you don't have a better swing than that man has. He has the ability to keep his hands back and float. It almost looks like that he's flipping the bat through the strike zone. Well, this is a changeup. He gets fooled a little bit. You're going to see that he hits it down on the end of the bat, just a tad. But he has the ability to stay behind the ball and swings as easy as anybody I've ever seen with the capability of hitting 40 home runs.
So he's at first, and now Cal Ripken gets up there. Just that base hit and Ripken coming up and the music starting, and all of a sudden the ballpark took on a very different feel. Ripken making his 17th consecutive opening day start, his 3rd at third base last year, and then way back in 1982.
When we were talking about critiquing this Baltimore ball club and we went to the bullpen, one other thing that they don't seem to have any more of is speed. Alomar and Davis can run, Anderson can run, but they just don't seem to want to run anymore. At least last year, they didn't run, and I was talking to Ray Miller before the game about it, and he said that the fact is that there were so many people hurt that could run that they just shut the game down and played basically the way the Orioles used to play. Not very many bunts and a lot of three-run home runs.
Did he give you the impression he's going to try to change that this year?
If people are healthy, he's going to give them the green light and go.
0-2 on Ripken, and a fastball high. Brady Anderson has stolen 50 bases in the season. Roberto Alomar has stolen 50. And as we said, Eric Davis in his younger years once stole 80. Jeffrey Hammonds is a guy who can run. He just can't find a position right now because of all these veterans in front of him.
Well, he's a good player. He's such a good player.
Strike three called, and Ripken is retired. And there's our first disagreement of the regular season. Cal didn't like the call at all. Let's go back to the studio and get an update. Here's Gary Miller.
EA Sports takes us to Arlington, and the White Sox land it to John Burkett. They've already scored twice in a Robin Ventura homer. Mike Cameron will knock in a couple of more. Ray Ordonez and Norton score. Frank Thomas would also knock in a run and make it 5-0. It's 7-0 as we go back to Camden Yards.
And Gary, a very upset Cal Ripken Jr. back to the Baltimore dugout. A strikeout victim here in the second. B.J. Surhoff, the batter, with a squibber back to the mound. There's one, and Alex Martinez turns a nice double play. First time we've had a chance to see the rookie, and he makes a nice one. A 1-6-3 double play ends the Orioles' second, and just like that.
Clear night in the outback. They say you can see every single star in the sky. And people come from all over with one thing on their mind, food.
That looks like a steak knife to me.
From juicy steak to tender chicken, fresh fish to barbecued ribs.
And up ahead, ladies and gents, dinner.
You'll see things you won't see anywhere else.
Outback Steakhouse, no rules, just right.
What do you look for in grass seed? Quick results?
We seeded it with Scott's seed last fall. As soon as I planted it, boom, it just came in.
A really terrific lawn?
And it feels like crushed velvet under your feet. It's wonderful.
How about weeds? Bargain brands can contain thousands of weed seeds that can ruin your lawn forever.
You can spend a dollar or two less for a bag of seed.
But you don't want weeds in your grass seed.
Scott's Premium Grass Seed, 99 and 99 100% weed-free for a beautiful lawn guaranteed.
Demanded better training facilities. Insisted on new uniforms and equipment. Held out for hundreds of free tickets. These guys will stop at nothing to get whatever they can for the Boys and Girls Clubs of America. Major League Baseball charities and the Boys and Girls Clubs of America, giving kids a world of opportunities.
Gary Miller with you in the studios. Big opening day here on ESPN, a triple header, and it has not started out well for the traditional opening team, the Cincinnati Reds. Barry Larkin out for at least a month. Mike Remlinger, who just found out he was starting when Dave Berman got traded. Pokey tries to turn two, get him out of the inning against the Padres, and that was only the beginning of Pokey playing Pukey. He has made four errors on opening day, three in this inning. The four errors tied the all-time opening day record set by Stringer of the Cubs back in 1941. But, of course, opening day back then was April 15th.
Four errors already for Pokey Rice. Not the kind of way you want to get your season. You spend 6 months thinking about opening day, and then you have a tough day like Pokey Rice.
Well, I hate that for a kid. He is a fine defensive shortstop, and as good a young player as I've seen defensively at that position in a long time.
There's Felix Martinez, the young Kansas City shortstop. He chased that outside pitch, having seen the way it was being called in the ground ball, and he's retired, one down.
Some days in this game, reaches up and bites you, doesn't it, buddy?
And you know what? You won't lose sleep as much, but it can humble you up here just as much as it can humble you down there.
I know it. If I worry about it up here like I worried about it down there, I'm just going to retire for good.
Back to the top of the order for Johnny Damon, who struck out his first time up. Kansas City leading 1-0 on a Dean Palmer RBI groundout, scoring Jeff King in the second inning. Damon's got his work cut out for him here in the early going. We talked about Larry Sutton, a first baseman, who's out in right field. Hal Morris, a first baseman, is out in left field. So I think on anything in the gap, Johnny Damon better get on his horse and get there.
Probably both of the corner outfielders cheating toward the line.
Mm-hmm. And all said and done, Jeff Conine will probably be back and left. Right field's up in the air right now. Ernie Young is with the Royals. Picked up on waivers from Oakland. But he's more of a natural center fielder, so Johnny Damon might learn a few things out there. Mussina again pitching ahead. It's one ball, two strikes. Fastball sent to left center. Anderson going back. And still back, makes the catch on the track.
What I see with Mussina right now is he's just establishing a way. Remember the pump punch out there, fastball on the outside part of the plate, puts his head down thinking that ball might have a chance to go, and Brady was able to run it down. But he's going to have to start establishing some balls on the inside part of the plate now because the hitters are starting to already adjust to that fastball away.
Second time through the order now, beginning with Damon. Here's Offerman, who also struck out his first time up, and Mussina staying away, getting strike one. Here's a guy who seems to really have found a home in Kansas City after some tough years as a shortstop with the Dodgers. A ton of errors. Came over, played a little first base, now has moved to second base, hitting for a good average, and seems to have found himself defensively as well.
Well, he doesn't have to make that throw at shortstop. I saw him play when he first came up with the Dodgers and made 42, 47 errors. Caught the ball pretty well, but had a tough time throwing the ball with accuracy. Second base, you take that scare away from yourself.
Chris Hoyles obviously thought it was strike three. Jim McKean said, a little high.
Well, everything can't be a strike, Chris. Dang. Calling the ball high. Look right here. Look at the catcher's mask. That's right there. If it's below the catcher's mask, it's not a high pitch. Usually right at the catcher's mask is the borderline pitch where they usually give it to the hitter.
It's right about the belt. And that one went the hitter's way. One and two. Do you think the hitters would rather see the belt high pitch called a strike and that outside pitch that Messina's getting called a ball?
Just absolutely, absolutely. You can't reach those balls out there. Belt high is a mistake. I wouldn't care if they called it all the way up to my neck, you know, and just call the outside part of the plate correctly.
And outside, but called a strike. And Jose Offerman's now a frustrated guy.
Can't hit that pitch.
No. The strike zone on the field is nothing like the strike zone on the rule book, and it's working in Messina's favor here this afternoon. 1-0 Kansas City.
Here's something you should never do with your eyeglasses unless they're made from Flexon. Even after bending and twisting, Flexon frames still look and fit great. Feel free to fall asleep in your glasses. Feel free to squeeze your Flexon frames. Feel free to kid around. Flexon frames, durable, comfortable, light. Ask for them by name. Flexon by Marshawn.
For 100 years, Bibb, the Michelin man, has symbolized the Michelin spirit, our never-ending quest to invent the best tires in the world. Tires to help you get where you're going in comfort and confidence with peace of mind. Michelin, celebrating 100 years of innovation because so much is riding on your tires.
There have been only 7 Wheaties champions this century. Better make that 8. Introducing Tiger Woods, a new generation of Wheaties champion.
Net camera inside a baseball wasn't the best way to get a close-up of Larry Walker's batting gloves. Franklin Carbon Fiber Batting Gloves. The official batting glove of Major League Baseball.
Moscow, we have a problem.
ESPN's opening day special is brought to you by Franklin, the official batting glove of Major League Baseball, and by Wheaties, the breakfast of champions. And a welcome back to Baltimore, everybody. 90 degrees here at Camden Yards. Dan Schulman and Ray Knight with you. The first game of three you will see this afternoon and this evening here on ESPN. 1-0 Kansas City. Tim Belcher on the mound for the Royals. And this is Joe Carter's first at bat as a member of the Baltimore Orioles.
Danny Joe's one of my all-time favorite hitters. I know you've seen a lot of him, but man alive, if you look at his consistency in 11 out of the last 13 years, over 100 runs batted in. Last year, 102. Has hit as many as 42 home runs. He has such a great idea of the strike zone, the shortest power stroke that I've seen in a long, long time. Reminds me a lot of the young Glenn Davis when Glenn Davis was over in our league. He was never committed to the breaking ball, stayed back on the fastball, and just used those hands. Some kind of competitor, great, great hustler, and there you see.
1-2-3, and what they have in common is they're all Baltimore Orioles, the three top active RBI guys in baseball. Just a little bit of experience over here. I talked to Carter yesterday at length, and he said it was really strange when he got here to Baltimore yesterday. Spring training wasn't that different, but to get here and hear the fans cheering for him instead of against him as a member of the Blue Jays was something a little bit different. And he said he always wanted to finish his career in Toronto. It didn't work out, and he's thrilled to get an opportunity to go back to the playoffs with Baltimore.
Well, he has the best play coverage, and I mean the best. I'm not saying that just to throw it out there. He has the best play coverage of sliders away of any right-handed hitter I've seen. Watch this pitch right here. It's a slider going down and away, probably 2 or 3 inches off the plate, low, and he still is able to spoil the pitch and get to another pitch.
And they'll try inside. And what's amazing about him, too, is when he hits the pitch down and away, he doesn't hit it to right. He still manages to hook it to left.
Boy, I tell you, when I was playing third base, I'd see him go out after that ball, and you'd move to the left thinking the ball was going to be hit in the hole, and he'd hit it to your right.
2-2 the count. Joe Carter has not hit seventh in a lineup as low as seventh in 12 years. And he says as long as his name is in the lineup, he doesn't care. And it remains to be seen whether with the likes of Carter, Baines, Hammonds, Eric Davis, are there enough at-bats to go around between all these guys. Harold Baines wants to get in there and play a little bit too. Carter with a high fly ball left center. It'll stay in the park. Morris drifting back on it, just his 11th game ever in the outfield. Makes the catch as we send you back to Gary Miller.
EA Sports takes it to Synergy Field. And it's Ricardo Jordan against Tony Gwynn. Launches a two-run shot. Jordan is also homered in this game. Ray, we love having you, and you better be glad you're not in Cincinnati today.
Feeling pretty good about things now?
No, man.
It's tough.
That's a place that's history in my life. Yep. And I can't say that I enjoyed it. I really
Cincinnati, looking at the prospects of a long year, just traded away their number one starter, already down 6-0 on opening day. Here's Chris Hoyles. Another one of the Orioles who battled through an injury-plagued season a year ago. His number's down from where they'd have been previously. Hit by Palmeiro, Tim Belcher has been outstanding. Three strikeouts, a couple of ground balls, including one that started a double play, and then the fly ball by Carter. Bordick, and then Brady Anderson potentially this inning.
Timmy Belcher was out of baseball 3 years ago and called Jim Bowden. Jim Bowden offered him a job in AAA. Then he did well in AAA and was traded for Roger Saukele, and he made a tremendous comeback. When you're talking about competitors, there's no one in the game that likes to compete more than this man.
He's ahead 1-2 on Hoyles. It's amazing with the state of pitching right now and more expansion. If you can throw the ball near the plate, you can probably convince somebody to give you a tryout. Dennis Martinez looks like he's going to be in the Atlanta rotation. Dave Steed is making a comeback after 5 years out of the game. Belcher seems young by comparison at 36.
Well, you're right about throwing the ball around the plate. In my short tenure as manager, the thing that wears you out, completely just scalds you mentally, is having a guy to go out there and not throw strikes. Doug Drabek made a living out of throwing strikes and won a Cy Young over there with Pittsburgh. When people are around the plate, you make the hitter swing the bat, and subsequently your defense plays much better baseball.
And strike three called right at the knees of Hoyles, and Tim Belcher already has four strikeouts in this game through 2 2/3.
Here he comes with a fastball right down, borderline strike, right down the middle. Ball moves in. I think Hoyles was looking for the breaking ball right there, because that's a pitch that you have to be able to spoil or foul off, especially with two strikes. Had to be sitting breaking ball.
Hoyles sits down. Two down in the inning, and the number nine hitter is the shortstop, Mike Borden. Take it a little bit low. Kind of a rough offensive season for Bordick last year. He was around 200 until after the All-Star break. Got himself up to 236 with a good September. They love his defense. They like a little more offense from the bottom of the order.
Well, he's the type of guy, you go out and you get the pitchers that you can to throw sinkers, you get the outfielders that can run balls down, and then you put all that together, and then you've got to find some glue. This man's the glue of this ball club. Tony La Russa says he's his favorite all-time player, and that's saying a lot. And so if you know he's Tony La Russa's favorite ball player, you know that he goes out and plays the game correctly.
And he's got to be a lot more relaxed this year. Last year he comes over and Cal Ripken has moved to third base, and whether it was Cal's decision or Davey Johnson's decision, was it a smooth move to move him over there to third? Mike Bordick, through no fault of his own, was kind of in the eye of the storm for a little while.
Well, he was, and I think you give that man we saw right there, Cal Ripken, great credit for that. He went ahead and made the move, knew he had to make it eventually, and went ahead and made the move. And it's something that Davey had talked about year before. He had tried Manny Alexander at shortstop a little bit, and it wasn't anything due to Cal's lack of playing abilities, just the fact that he's going to have much more longevity playing third base than playing a solid major league shortstop.
One ball, two strikes on Bordick, two down and nobody on in the third. And wouldn't you know it, but maybe the best young hitting prospect the Orioles have right now, Ryan Miner, the former All-American basketball player at Oklahoma. What position does he play? Third base. Well, now there's at least some preliminary talk. Would Cal Ripken be asked to move to first base next year if Miner's ready for the major leagues?
Well, you can bet they will. If they don't sign Palmeiro, then that's the natural fit.
2-2. And Palmeiro, one of the 14 players on this Baltimore team, up for free agency. And it seems very unlikely that he's going to come back. He's asking for a 5-year deal. The Orioles are talking about a 3-year deal. Two and two. And Bordick chases and is gone. And Tim Belcher, once through the order, has been almost untouchable. He has 5 strikeouts. And the Royals lead the Orioles 1-0.
Antonio, do you want a new car or truck? If you're looking, there's only one thing to remember. 800-460-WINK. Call today and get the best deal in Texas. Pontiacs, Buicks, Oldsmobiles, Chevrolet cars, even tough Chevy trucks. Don't shop all over town. Just let your fingers do the work. Get a complete price quote on any model, any color. Just call. It's easy. Never hassle for a new Buick, Olds, Pontiac, or Chevrolet price again. No obligation, no hassle. Just call and get the best deal in Texas. Winkler Motors exclusive Best Deal in Texas hotline.
Hey everyone, there are birds in the bird bath.
I can't see.
Excuse me, but I think you need a room with a view. Enjoy the outdoors by calling Rooms with a View. Compare and save 50% on the nation's finest solariums and sunrooms with payments as low as $98 a month. Call now for a limited time. Every room gets free Berber carpet. Rooms with a View. For a free estimate, call 1-800-522-2171.
Homeowners in need of a home equity loan. It's time you called Superior Bank FSB to get the Superior difference. Superior Bank is a federal savings bank which for over 75 years has been helping homeowners save money by refinancing at lower rates, consolidate their high interest debt, or pay off overdue credit cards. Superior has helped thousands of homeowners who were rejected elsewhere or who have had credit problems in the past. Homeowners, call Superior Direct at 1-888-678-7777 and get the Superior difference.
Opening day 98 continues here on ESPN, and so does the slaughter in Cincinnati. Kevin Brown with the bases loaded off Gabe White. That pass, Reggie Sanders, for a three-run double for the pitcher. Tony Gwynn off the inning with a two-run homer. It is now 10-0 after a six-run seventh, Ray.
Get off me, man.
10-0. Cincinnati on the wrong end of that score against San Diego. Here, a much closer one, moving to the fourth in a pitcher's duel. This was supposed to be the year of the home run, wasn't it? Everybody's going to be muscling up and hitting them out. 1-0 Kansas City in the fourth. Hal Morris, the batter, grounded out his first time up. Heading in the number three spot for the Royals. And Mussina, nothing fancy, fastball strike.
When you're talking about home runs, I think what's directly contributed to the home run explosion over the last few years, it's not necessarily the bad pitching, but the pitcher's bad selection of pitches. And that's, people used to throw fastballs as a dominant pitch. Now they've gotten where they throw their best pitch or out pitch is a split finger, a cutter, some type of curveball, palm ball, and as a result, you don't have the command of those balls as you have a fastball. And another point of that about that ball comes in at about 78, 80 miles an hour. You have more time to react.
Now, pitching coaches still preaching to their pitchers to throw the fastball?
Yeah, they do, but they always talk about another pitch, a third pitch, a fourth pitch. And the toughest pitch to hit is a located fastball with a little bit of movement on it, late movement. You can locate it down and in, up and away, tight, sinking away. But as Messina's shown early, you locate that fastball, it's tough to get on.
Into center field, on comes Brady, but it'll drop in front of him. And Hal Morris with a base hit to get the Royals started here in the fourth. Now there is plenty more baseball coming your way here on ESPN. Not only the rest of today, but also tomorrow night, a Wednesday night of baseball, begins with the San Francisco Giants in Houston to take on the Astros. Barry Bonds and friends against Bagwell, Biggio, and Moises Alou for Houston. And the late game, a good one between the Yankees and the Angels. You'll get a look at Chuck Knobloch and Chili Davis to the Yankee pinstripes. The Angels have added former Yankee Cecil Fielder. So a lot of storylines in both of those games tomorrow night. Morris the lead at first, and the batter Jeff King. He'll be down in Houston to check in on the Astros and Giants.
Yes, I am going down there to meet John Miller to the game tomorrow night.
See if Houston can repeat as National League Central Division champs. Going to get a tough fight from St. Louis this year, although both teams just racked by injuries right now.
Well, Houston's going to have the best offensive club I think they've ever had. You had Moises Alou to that ball club, and certainly they lost. When they lost Darryl Cowell, they lost a big chunk of that starting rotation. And their big problem is, are they going to be able to score enough runs to hold people down enough to get enough victories to win that division? The Cardinals, I think, are the club to beat in that division.
A full year of McGuire, runner not going, and King takes high. And if they can get a healthy Brian Jordan, it sounds like he's feeling a lot better about things.
Well, they got so much speed, so much power. Ronnie Gant can steal 20 bases. Gaetti can still hit 20 home runs. Ray Langford, one of the best five or six players in the game, all around with his power, his speed, his defensive ability, his throwing arm. They just got Royce Clayton developing to a great young shortstop. Delino DeShields coming back from two off seasons. So you can just go on and on and on for that ball club with the talent they have.
Down and away, 2-0 to Jeff King. Mussina in a bit of a jam here with Hal Morris already at first base.
I mentioned Jeff King, fastball hitter. He's a great cripple hitter, too. And that's a pitch. He has the ability to look for a ball in an area and lock in on that area and not swing at anything but a pitch in that area. And it doesn't have to be a fastball. It can be a changeup or a breaking ball. I saw him hit a 3-2 John Smiley changeup for a home run, or it may be in Pete Schurk changeup for a home run 2 years ago when there's no way he should have been able to get close to that changeup.
Something in his mind there, but got something different, and it's 2-1.
Well, when you have five pitches, you know, and the key there is as they always talk about, as we look at his home runs last year, how you take off and you add to the hitter's bat. If you throw the ball tight inside, he has to quicken his bat. If you throw it soft away, he has to wait. And Mussina has that big differential between his fastball, 95, and that curveball, about 75.
Fouled off, two balls and two strikes. Mussina battling back against King, who singled and scored the only run of the game back in the second inning.
And you see what he's doing. Jeff King, he pounded him inside the first time, and he got a ground ball to third. There he gets behind him 2-0 and then goes to 2-1 and busts him inside, and King can't get to that fastball. You do not want to get the ball out away from this man. He likes the ball out away. He likes the fastball, but he doesn't like to be pinched.
2-2 ripped down the left field line, but King out in front. There's the first nice catch by the ball girl down the line. Kansas City leading the Orioles 1-0 here in the fourth inning. King with 28 home runs and 112 RBIs. Last season as a member of the Royals, had some help with Jay Bell and Chili Davis that he doesn't have now. With big power numbers a year ago. Back through the mound and into center field, a base hit. And the Royals into business with runners at first and second here in the fourth.
Just a fastball down, little sinker out away from him. He just flipped it right back through the box the way we're taught. Two strikes, try to knock him off the mound.
And sets it up for Terry Pendleton, who had the big hit back in the second, the double. The middle of this Kansas City order is punishing Mike Mussina right now. Morris, King, and Pendleton have combined to go 4-for-5 already. Ripken in on the grass, inside the bag at third, and Palmeiro even with the bag at first. Royals will put a play on, perhaps. Pendleton squares to bunt. Mussina makes a great running catch. Remember, he has won the last two Gold Gloves at his position in the American League.
Boy, he's very difficult to bunt on, and that's something Tony Muser will learn if he doesn't know already. You know, you pretty much have to put a hit run on. It's just really, really difficult to get a ball down with Mussina on the mound. And there you had Cal Ripken playing it straight at third. So Messina's going to go straight to third base and make that play at third. So basically you're going to end up having one out. Runners are first and second. They're just changing positions. But very tough to bunt on.
And a big out for Mussina with another powerful hitter in Dean Palmer coming up. Kansas City out hitting the Orioles 4-1 so far. We talked a lot off the top of the show about the Orioles and their all-star team and their payroll and all that, but a good pitching performance can nullify a $74 million payroll in a hurry, and that's what Tim Belcher has been able to do through three innings so far.
But Timmy Belcher has always been a guy that through the first five innings, he has been as tough as anybody. Last year he took a beating in, I think, seven ball games where he gave up six or seven runs where he just took it for the bullpen. But he's as good a five-inning pitcher as there is around. You're going to see as he goes around the lineup twice, he loses a couple miles an hour on his fastball, and then he becomes more hittable. But he's always been tough at first four or five innings.
And we'll see how long both of these pitchers can go, this being their first start of the season. Belcher did not go further than five innings in the spring. Mussina, six innings is as far as he went. And now Mussina with a long look in at Jim McKean on that call. Did you ever have a starter come out and go nine for you on opening day?
I only had two opening days, bro. No, I didn't.
Baltimore especially with a very deep bullpen that Ray Miller won't be afraid to use. 1-1, the count on Palmer. Mussina's control has been impeccable in this game.
extraordinary about the number of pitches that he's thrown, but Ray Miller early in the season will want to keep a close eye on things and not extend him too far too soon. Morris at second, King at first, and a 1-2 count on Palmer. Jammed him, and a ground ball up the first baseline for Palmeiro, the sure out. Two down as the runners advance.
Let's look at that again.
Now look at the ESPN in-game box score so far. Shows all the damage from the Kansas City Royals, as you can see, has come from the heart of the order. Morris, King, and Pendleton. The Palmer RBI coming on a ground out. And now with two on and two out, Kansas City a base hit from breaking it open a little bit.
As I was saying this, look at that fastball up and in. What a great pitch by Mussina. Just sawing Palmer off. Palmer have a tendency to swing at bad balls, and he runs that fastball up and in on him and just eats him up.
Now Larry Sutton, the right fielder, grounded out his first time up. And a very nice swing for the Royals, hitting 333, 290 with Kansas City in limited opportunities last year. Morris coming down to third, King at second. This is the fifth consecutive year, if you can believe it, that Baltimore and Kansas City have opened up with one another. Just a quirk of the scheduling that the Royals always seem to draw the Orioles on opening day. It's been bad news for Kansas City lately. Maybe not today, though. A base hit by Sutton is going to score two. And the Royals jump out in front 3-0.
Just a fastball that gets up and out over the plate, and he fights it off. A little bit of movement in, fights it off to center field. We're seeing a little erratic with his control right now, getting the fastball up and not able to hit the corners away.
And Kansas City taking advantage, leading 3-0, out of hitting the Orioles 5-1. Mussina scuffling here in the fourth inning. We'll face the catcher, Mike Sweeney. Stop at third by Ripken from his knees. The force on Sutton. A fine play to end the inning by Cal Ripken Jr., but not before Larry Sutton spanks one up the middle to drive in two against Mike Mussina and extend the Kansas City lead to 3.
When sports cream, when legs are sore, when backs ache, when muscles hurt. Why sports cream? Rubbing it in brings fast pain relief. No medicine-y smell. Why sports cream? Because it works.
3 hours from now, this place will be filled with 18,000 screaming fans. And if I can take these Coors Lights, deliver them in all their frost-brewed glory, it is my name. They're gonna get cheering.
Hear me. Excuse me.
Two hours and 59 minutes from now.
Whether it's Iowa corn, California rice, or Louisiana cotton, John Deere knows a thing or two about harvesting. So for a change, we decided to have our engineers make something disappear. After all, somebody had to get mulching right. Introducing the Freedom Mulching System. While some may be impressed by its patents, we think you like the way it works, even on wet grass and leaves. Because although the problem is different, the name is still the same.
High-tech stocks, long-term bonds. What sets them off? When the herd follows a trend, we weigh our independent research against it. Are they headed in the right direction? Independent thinking. It can make the difference between winning and losing. Mutual funds from American Century. Invest in our thinking.
Zanardi, Andretti, Vassar. When's the last time you were stuck in traffic going 148 miles an hour? Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. Sunday at 4, only on ESPN.
And welcome back. back, everybody. Part of the opening day festivities here at Camden Yards. Food's good, but the Oriole fans not enjoying what they're seeing so far. 4-0 Kansas City lead at the expense of Mike Mussina, as Brady Anderson's going to lead off the fourth for Baltimore. And Anderson up there swinging. Fly ball into left. Morris stays with it. One down. Let's go to Gary Miller.
All right, Dan, we'll get right back out to Camden Yards. But Mark McGwire has his first opening day in the National League for his 13th season. Remember, he hit 24 homers in 2 months as a Cardinal. Now he'll spend the whole season there. He had 58 a year ago. Here's his first at bat of 1998 in a standing O at Busch.
58 home runs in 1997 for Mark McGwire. First at bat of 1998. Ball one.
I remember Mark McGwire being asked about National League pitchers, said Pedro Martinez was the best. We saw that monster blast he hit off of Ramon, but Ramon is just as nasty as his younger brother. And you just saw one of his weapons with that great changeup.
One ball, one strike, two out, nobody on, first inning. September 16th, facing Ramon Martinez after signing that big contract. Look at this blast. But set up here at a ball and two strikes, and taking strike three over the outside corner. A leadoff hit, a man out stealing. Martinez faces...
Just in time to see him strike out. So he's 1-for-3 in his career against Martinez, who goes through the order scoreless, St. Louis and L.A. We'll keep you up to date on all the other action. Right now, let's get back to Baltimore.
Gary, thank you. You just cannot watch Mark McGwire swing the bat enough. Whether he homers or strikes out, it's always entertaining, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
While you were away in St. Louis, Roberto Alomar with a fly ball to left. So two up and two down on fly balls for Baltimore here in the fourth. And here's Eric Davis. Whistling one into right center field, a base hit. Just the second hit of the afternoon for Baltimore. Now we have a change for Kansas City. Ernie Young has come into the game in right field. Larry Sutton, we told you he was a converted first baseman playing right. He's back in his natural first base position right now, which means Jeff King has come out of the game, and we are endeavoring at this point to find out exactly why.
It must be an injury. I don't believe they'd remove Jeff King this early. He must have got tight legs or something.
There's Palmeiro, a base hit his first time up. Two outs and Eric Davis at first. Baltimore trying to get untracked against Tim Belcher. Jeff King was on base in the top half of this inning and came around to score for the second time today, so maybe tweak something base running. Saw the batting average on Palmeiro from last year, 254, very unlike him, and he has vowed to go the other way more this year and to be more patient. Ray Miller has challenged him to walk 100 times. They want him to forget about that short porch and right over the scoreboard and worry a little bit more about making contact.
Well, when a man hits 34, 35 home runs, I don't worry too much about his average. You know, he's hitting four for run production. There's been a lot of people who hit 250 and hit 35, 40 home runs. And you start trying to be too cute up there, trying to flip the ball to left field, all of a sudden you hit 25, 40 doubles and drive in 80.
There goes Davis. Palmeiro swinging away. Lifts one in the air, foul ground. Dean Palmer there to squeeze it, and the inning is over. The Orioles get a base hit, but nothing more, and trail the Royals 3-0.
The Sabre Safety Day sweepstakes is almost over, so hurry into your Buick dealer today. It's your last chance to win one of 10 LeSabres, or a home security system, or one of thousands of other First Alert products. Plus, you can get low 1.9% APR GMAC financing on a new LeSabre. So hurry into your Buick dealer today. Sweepstakes ends March 31st.
Figaro, 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 Figaro. Figaro here, hey Figaro, Figaro there, hey Figaro.
Vigoro up, Vigoro down, Vigoro.
Vigoro lawn fertilizer gives you more predictable, continuous feeding, whether it's hot, cold, wet, or dry. Vigoro. People everywhere are singing its praises. Vigoro. Only at the Home Depot.
Hampton Inn, we guarantee you'll be satisfied. Because we do the little things right. So the bigger things just sort of take care of themselves. Hampton Inn. We make it easy to take it easy.
How do you get this equipment to these troops when there's a river between them? Build a bridge. Problem solving. You need it now in college. Learn it now in the Army Reserve.
I like being in control. With this Dinnerx, I control the cause of my dandruff every day.
Dinnerx Advanced Formulas Medicine doesn't just treat the symptoms. It controls a leading cause of dandruff called P.O. Valley.
Now that's serious control.
Dinnerx Advanced Formula.
Welcome back to Opening Day here on ESPN. Dan Schulman and Ray Knight with you in Baltimore, where the visiting Royals have a 3-0 lead on Mike Mussina and the Baltimore Orioles. The Orioles have really struggled against Tim Belcher, who has been outstanding. Mussina started off outstanding, but struggled last inning, giving up two runs. This is the number 9 hitter here, shortstop Felix Martinez, who goes around, says Terry Kraft, and it's strike one. Kansas City forced to fill in some of these gaps with younger, cheaper players, with the loss of Jay Bell, Shirley Davis, and Martinez, one of those who takes advantage. Wild swing, and it's 0-2. After Martinez, back to the top of the order for Johnny Damon and then Jose Offerman. 0-2 from Mussina. Great breaking ball to freeze Martinez. One down, 5 strikeouts. And let's go to Gary Miller.
The center fielder, number 8.
Dan, a little bit of history. Back in the National League for the first time since 1965. Milwaukee has a team. Fernando Vina flies out against Greg Maddux. They did get one hit off Maddux. But Chipper Jones already has the first RBI for the Braves this year. So the team that took over their city is down to them 1-0.
Yeah, it's a strange one with the Brewers playing the Braves. How do you feel about Milwaukee switching leagues?
Well, because I was a Milwaukee Brave fan in 57 and 58 with Eddie Matthews and Johnny Logan and all those guys, I like him in the National League. Plus, Phil Gardner is a great friend of mine, and he's a National League guy. So.
And they could make some noise in that division.
They get a solid ball club.
Batter Johnny Damon, 0-2, as we receive word that Jeff King left the game with lower back pain. After a good start, a couple of hits, scored a couple of runs. Tony Muser forced to take out his cleanup hitter here on opening day.
It's funny how you get older. I did basically the same thing. I started my career as a shortstop and then moved to third base. And then as I started to break down, ended up at first base. And I DH'd a little bit. Fortunately for this ball club, you can play Hal Morris and Morris at first base and DH Jeff King. If playing out there and running hurts him.
And another good breaking ball by Mussina to get Damon. 2 up and 2 down here on strikeouts. Let's go to Dave McGowan, the new PA announcer here at the Orioles, replacing the legendary Rex Barney.
Boy, what a great man Rex Barney was. I got to play with the Orioles in 1987. He used to tell me about all those Dodgers. He was a guy that could throw the ball 95, 98 miles an hour and just didn't have any control. He said nobody would hit against him in spring training. But what a great loss, Rex Barney. Did you get to know Rex very well?
No, not very well at all. Passed away late last year. McGowan open auditions, over 300 people, with McGowan as the guy who won the job. Orioles played an exhibition game here 2 days ago, so McGowan had a chance to get over his jitters in an exhibition game. And admitted he was a little bit nervous. This is his first regular season game. Calls it a dream come true as an Oriole fan for years and years. 2-1, the count on Offerman. Mussina staying away.
I don't blame him.
Brown has got six strikeouts already, including Offerman twice. Now Morris waiting on deck. Should Offerman survive? Mussina not likely to let that happen if he can keep finding the corner. A 297 hitter last year, Jose Offerman. See, he knows he has to go out there and fight off that pitch, because if he lets it go, it's strike three.
Boy, it becomes so difficult, but good hitters will do that, and then you're forcing to make a mistake, get a ball on the plate a little bit more, and do something with it, hit a line drive over shortstop. I think a good pitch right here would be a fastball hard inside. Going away again.
Breaking ball, lined softly down to Palmeiro, and a three-up, three-down inning for Mussina, his third of the afternoon, but it's the Royals who have capitalized and taken a lead.
We've discovered more wood in a nearby house.
Destroy it.
Terminix rules the termites with our advanced termite control systems. Call 1-800-TERMINIX. No bugs, no hassles.
I've been vending Coors Light for a long time. It's who I am. At home, it's, hey, beer man, pass the peas. When the mail comes, it says, hey, beer man, you may have won $10 million. Being the beer man's a wonderful thing. People know Frost Brew Refreshment. They're always happy to see me, and I'm recognized wherever I go.
Hey, beer man.
Hey, bobbinhead doll man. Coors Light! Coors Light!
Jockey. Great underwear.
Let them know you're Jockey.
Life's a trip, and it takes money to get where you're going. That's what mutual funds are for. At Janus, making money means looking for breaks nobody else saw coming, jumping on and riding them in. No matter what the market's doing, there are great companies to invest in. Janus finds them, so you can get there. Janus No Load Mutual Funds.
ESPN's opening day special is brought to you by Janus No Load Mutual Funds. And by Jockey, makers of great underwear. Come on, let them know you're Jockey. And the applause you hear for Cal Ripken as he gets sent to lead off here in the bottom of the fifth. Oriole fans looking for something to get excited about here on opening day. This team of all-stars has been shut down by the capable Tim Belcher so far. Just two quiet hits through four innings. Ripken caught looking his first time up on a call that he didn't like. Pops one back of the plate. Sweeney will make the catch up against the screen and record the out.
This is a great play here without trapping that ball against the screen. So many times you get a catcher go up there, and what you do is you get up against the screen and then catch the ball coming back to you. That almost looked like a trap. But Jim McKeon right on the play.
For the first out of the fifth inning. Now the left fielder B.J. Surhoff hit into a double play his first time up. B.J. is getting a lot of attention recently here for the Baltimore Orioles, as one of the four key players, really vital players to this Baltimore team, who are free agents at the end of the year. Surhoff, Alomar, Palmeiro, and Scott Erickson. And of the four, it seems most likely that Surhoff is going to be re-signed. Peter Angelos, the owner for the Orioles, has taken over all the negotiations. He's talked to Palmeiro. He's talked to Alomar, Erickson, and Surhoff. It seems they're closest with Surhoff and furthest away with Palmeiro, with Erickson and Alomar perhaps somewhere in between. But some of these guys, Ray, and I'm sure you can relate, don't want to talk contract during the season. They don't want any extra distractions.
No, you really don't. And there's so much time to get it done in the offseason. Owners getting involved in contracts are very, very difficult. I don't even know why you have a general manager.
Fly ball, fairly deep center field. Off the bat of Surhoff. Damon is there, two down, as we send you back to Gary.
Dan, Curt Schilling, who posted over 300 strikeouts a year ago and threw two hitter for eight innings a year ago, did it to the Mets this afternoon. The two hits by Tim Spear. He struck him out there, though, then got Rey Ordonez, nine strikeouts in eight innings of work. Look at Dennis Cook move, but Scotty Rowland, the reigning rookie of the year, throws him out at first. We've gone to the 10th. Franco now in pitching. Schilling done for the day.
What a tremendous performance by Schilling in another pitcher's duel. Other than that Cincinnati game, the starting pitchers have looked pretty good so far today around the majors.
Getting back to that Surhoff thing just for a moment. B.J. Surhoff is as hard-nosed player as there is in this game. He's the closest thing to a throwback, he and Ken Caminiti. The thing about B.J., he'll play third base, first base, left field, can catch for you. He's just the type of guy that you can build a franchise around and that you don't want to lose because he can fill in so many gaps.
And it seems, again, that he and Peter Angelos have done a lot of talking and aren't that far apart. Orioles won't be able to sign everybody. They already have the highest payroll in the history of baseball this year. And with 14 free agents, obviously, they're going to lose some of them. Carter just a one-year deal as he comes over. This one is popped up. And over near the tarp to make the catch is Hal Morris, who this inning switched with Larry Sutton. Left fielder became the first baseman. First baseman became the left fielder. You need a scorecard here today.
And now, golf's not hard with Tiger Woods and the AirZoom T-Range.
Too many people overcomplicate the golf swing. Today, we're going to make it simple. First, place the ball off the inside of your left heel. Second, bend your knees slightly. And finally, keep the left arm straight. Voila, you're on your way to a better golf swing. Of course, you also want to maintain the triangle too, and lead with your hips. And other than taking the club back low and slow, that's all there is to it. As long as you allow your weight to shift to the inside of your right foot and keep the club face square and your left heel planted and the V between your thumb and forefinger pointing to your right shoulder and the club grip gently like a wounded bird and your left shoulder under your chin, allowing your hands to rotate through the impact area and maintaining a stable lower body position while finishing with your belt buckle facing the target with your rear elbow hinge. That should help take the mystery out of the golf swing. This is Tiger Woods reminding you that we can all be better.
Tired of carrying all that heavy water around every time you vacuum the wet basement? Get the new ShopVac QPV, the quiet vacuum that sucks water from one place and pumps it to another. Because you've got better things to do than lug water around. ShopVac, the only thing more powerful is our name.
What do you look for in grass seed? Quick results?
We seeded it with Scott's seed last fall. As soon as I planted it, boom, it just came in.
A really terrific lawn?
And it feels like crushed velvet under your feet. It's wonderful.
How about weeds? Bargain brands can contain thousands of weed seeds that can ruin your lawn forever.
You can spend a dollar or two less for a bag of seed.
But you don't want weeds in your grass seed.
Scott's Premium Grass Seed, 99 and 99 100% weed-free for a beautiful lawn guaranteed.
Welcome back to ESPN's coverage of opening day from Baltimore. The Kansas City Royals leading the Orioles by a score of 3-0. It's been a very well-pitched game, especially by Tim Belcher of Kansas City. Mike Mussina has looked dominant at times and has had a couple of rough spots. Hal Morris got the two-run fourth for the Royals starter with a base hit, came around to score. Started off in left field and now has moved in to play first base for Kansas City. And a strike on the corner. We've said that a few times today.
Yes, you have. Hal Morris, we talked about him being an outstanding hitter last year. Riddled with that shoulder, had major shoulder surgery. Comes back to a ball club in American League, and he'll hit 300. And he also plays excellent first base. You know, they talked about DHing him because of Jeff King there in Conine in left field, but there's no drop-off at first base when you have Hal Morris playing over there.
Mussina ahead 0-2. He already has six strikeouts in this game as he misses down and away. You know, Mussina Ray made an interesting point when he talked about expectations for this season coming off the incredible playoff performance he had. He said, you can't expect me to go out there and do that. It may have been a once-in-a-lifetime situation. Maybe I can do it again, but you never know. But he has raised the expectations for himself.
Well, I think he has to have great expectations. Here's a guy that has won 101 ball games the last 6 years, 19 games being the high and 14 the low. Every time Tom Seaver went out, he expected to strike out 14, 15 people. Every time Nolan Ryan went out, he expected to do that. I think this young man needs to get his mindset that he can go out and pitch those type games every outing, and I believe he can.
It's Morris, strikeout number 7. We're going to see some more great pitchers tonight as ESPN's opening day baseball special continues. The next game comes your way at 7 Eastern, Cleveland at Seattle. Kenny Lofton is back with the Tribe. Ken Griffey Jr. leading the M's and Randy Johnson on the mound against Charles Nagy. And then the third game, Colorado at Arizona. The Diamondbacks debut against Larry Walker and the Colorado Rockies. Andy Bennis, Daryl Kyle, a couple more. Great pitchers getting set to go here on opening day. There's Ernie Young getting his first at bat. And the shuffling necessitated by Jeff King's back pain. Young has come into the game and is now playing right field. Spent last year with Oakland. And spent part of the season down in the minors as well. You think back to some of the things that Mussina accomplished. He snapped Randy Johnson's 16-game winning streak in the regular season here in Baltimore. And then he beat Johnson twice in the playoffs. He won 2 games in the division series. He had 2 dominant starts in the ALCS, but received no decisions because the Orioles just couldn't score for him as he strikes out another one.
I'll tell you how strongly I feel about Mike Mussina. You can tag Randy Johnson and you can talk about Kevin Brown, and you can talk about any other pitcher in the National League. And I would, right now, in any lottery, I'd pick this man. I wouldn't be afraid to take him over anybody. That's how strongly I feel about his ability to pitch. It's seldom that you find a man that has that much command of that many pitches and has the knowledge and the wherewithal to know what to do with him. And he's got the whole package.
Fouled off by Pendleton. 8 strikeouts now for Mussina. Leading a starting staff that includes Scott Erickson, Jimmy Key, Scott Kamenicki, and Doug Drabek. These guys have accomplished a lot. Pat Gillick saying yesterday, 2 horses in Mussina and Erickson. But the other 3 guys, is Key going to be healthy? What kind of a year will Drabek have? There are some questions toward the end of that rotation. Those pitchers do like to hang out together in the river.
Oh, they do. Surely do. That's the way it's supposed to be. You sit there, you watch the opposition hitters, you talk about what it looks like their bats are doing, if they're out in front of the ball, if they're behind the ball. And you can learn a lot just by sitting right there and discussing it together. Forming a game plan for your whole pitching staff so that next time you have a pitching coach pitchers meeting going over the oppositional hitters, that you have a real good idea how you want to pitch guys, and everybody has input in those meetings.
Drabek, the new face in the Baltimore rotation. And Drabek knows Ray Miller very well, of course. Miller, for many years, was the pitching coach with Pittsburgh. Drabek won the Cy Young with Pittsburgh in 1990, so they have a previous relationship. And now, although Miller is the manager and Mike Flanagan is the new pitching coach, you know Miller's going to have some input here and there.
Well, he surely is, but Mike Flanagan also pitched for him for about 10 years, so he's a disciple of Ray Miller, so he's not teaching him anything differently than Ray Miller did.
And a breaking ball. Pendleton goes around, and Mussina strikes out the side. He has 9 strikeouts in the game.
A whitening toothpaste that really works and has all the fluoride I need each day.
Aquafresh Whitening gives you all the fluoride of Crest cavity protection, but whitens better. And Aquafresh is safe to use every day.
Look, what makes Aquafresh Whitening so special?
Aquafresh's patented tricline formula gently breaks up stains to help get teeth their whitest. Not even Rembrandt whitens better.
In that case, count me in.
Aquafresh Whitening, safe to use every day for dazzling whiter teeth.
There have been only 7 Wheaties champions this century. Better make that 8. Introducing Tiger Woods, a new generation of Wheaties champion. What you're seeing is amazing because this tire is flat. That's right. Moments ago, it was punctured and lost all air pressure. It's the new Goodyear AquaSteel Run Flat. If it weren't, this is what could have happened. Instead, the new AquaSteel drives you up to 50 miles at 55 miles per hour to safety. New AquaSteel. Serious freedom. Only from Goodyear. Goodyear, Goodyear.
When you've lived 7 or 8 lives, you can make some pretty long-lasting friendships. But even when you've known someone forever...
You take a check.
Of course, I'll take your check.
Could I see some ID, please?
Without ID, you're history. Use the Visa check card. It's an ATM card that deducts directly from your checking account everywhere Visa's accepted. Works like a check, only better.
By the way, Caesar liked me better.
George Washington stopped the British at Valley Forge, but he never made stops like these. He never watched hockey, and now he's dead. Watch the NHL on ESPN2. Before life passes you by.
And welcome back to Camden Yards. It is 3-0 Kansas City. A sold-out crowd of nearly 47,000 people are here in Baltimore today trying to figure out a way to get the offense going for the Orioles. This is the way the season ended for Baltimore last year. A station-to-station team, a team that waits for the home run. It hasn't come so far today against Tim Belcher. Chris Hoyle's going to lead off the bottom of the sixth. The catcher caught looking his first time up.
Well, they haven't really hit a ball hard. The ball that Eric Davis hit the right field, he hit off the end of the bat, and Rafael dumps a single in the right center that he gets jammed on. So they have not hit a ball hard yet.
And Belcher has now gone further in terms of innings here today than he went in any of his spring starts. He had a rough spring, mainly in one game against the Yankees in which he threw about 13 earned runs. That'll mess up your ERA in a hurry. But he's been around long enough to not put too much stock in spring numbers. 2-1.
Well, he's the type of guy that if he gives up 6 runs in one inning, he wants to go out there in the next inning. He's never been afraid to take the baseball, and I mentioned before, there were 7 outings last year, or 8 outings, where he got beat up and stayed out there for 6 or more innings, giving up 6 or 7 runs, so that inflated his ERA.
But his type of pitcher, the guy who can go out there and give you 200 innings, is becoming very popular with small market teams. You see Tom Candiotti going to Oakland, and he's the opening day starter there. And especially with Acuña out, the best thing they know about Belcher is he's going to give him 7 or 8 innings every time.
Heck, man, to get a guy to go 220 innings is a luxury nowadays. It's very difficult, other than your 1-2 starter, to get that kind of innings from people.
2-2, the count on Hoyles, and a fastball up and away.
Over the last 2 years, he's made a total of 67 starts for this ball club.
Getting hungry?
Oh, I'm always hungry for Boog's Rib. Is that Boog's?
That's Boog's Barbecue out there. That actually may have been the Bambino's rib joint. I don't think that was Boog's Barbecue. They've got so much to choose from. You got to take a stroll out there.
I might have to.
Yeah.
Can you hold it down right here?
Be back in an inning.
Yeah.
There it is, Bambino's ribs. Yeah, Boog's Barbecue, I think, is a little bit closer to the right field line. A lot of fun out there.
I talked to you earlier about Belcher and his 5 inning stints. All the way back in 89, he had 8 starts and 8 complete games.
Fly ball to right. Ernie Young makes the catch. One down as we send you back to Garrett.
Dan, we take it to the home of the world champions and the World Series MVP, Leivan Hernandez. Henry Rodriguez, his first at bat, first pitch he seizes a Cub, ends up in the patio. A 3-run shot. The Cubs score 3 in the first. Back to you.
All right, Gary, thank you. Well, we talked Astros, we talked Cardinals. A lot of people are picking the Cubs as a dark horse team in that division.
Well, I think they've improved. Obviously, Gonzalez is going to help them immensely. And it's time for them to improve.
Yeah, it is. They're overdue. There's Mike Bordick. Well, it looks like it's the Central Divisions again, which are anybody's game. Going back on the play is Offerman to make the catch. 2 down. If you haven't been paying attention over the winter, baseball looks a little bit different than it did last year with the addition of Tampa Bay and Arizona. The D-backs or Diamondbacks find their way into the National League West. And to keep the leagues at 16-14, the Milwaukee Brewers move from the American League to the National League. If you had leagues of 15-15, you would either need a lot of interleague play every day, really, or a lot of off days for teams. Neither solution which works. So Milwaukee, after the Kansas City Royals declined to do so, Milwaukee said yes, and they moved over the National League, and apparently their ticket sales are up, and they're all excited about meeting up with the Cubs and the Cardinals.
Nothing unusual for Brady being brushed back. He got hit 19 times last year, over 41 times the last 2 years in the big leagues, leading both the National and American League and hits batsmen.
Pretty tough guy, though. Played through a cracked rib last year and played through appendicitis.
That thought that I was going to tell you on Belcher, he had 8 complete games in 1989, which was his second year with the Dodgers. In the last 8 years, he's had 9 complete games.
Wow.
So he has pretty much become a 6-inning type pitcher, and we're going to see how he goes today.
Inside again, and it's 2-2. Belcher right now cruising in the 6th inning with 2 down and nobody on. He came into this inning having thrown only 65 pitches, so he'd be somewhere in the mid-70s now. Wanted it and didn't get it. Full count. Other than Jeff Montgomery, that Kansas City bullpen has a lot of names that you got to do some reading to learn a lot about these guys. Some young players who haven't been around very much. Montgomery anchoring the pen as always. Brady chased one down low and a ground ball down to first to retire the side. Belcher has set down 14 of the last 15 here on opening day at Camden Yards.
Birds in the bird bath.
I can't see.
Excuse me, but I think you need a room with a view. Enjoy the outdoors by calling Rooms with a View. Compare and save 50% on the nation's finest solariums and sunrooms with payments as low as $98 a month. Call now. For a limited time, every room gets free Berber carpet. Rooms with a View. For a free estimate, call 1-800-522-2171.
Paragon and HBO present Kids Day, featuring Warner Brothers' very own Bugs Bunny. Hey, kids, join us for a day of fun, food, and games. Absolutely free, Saturday, April 18th, from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. at San Pedro Park. Kids Day, join Paragon and HBO. You won't want to miss it. For more information, call 222-9641.
When it comes to building a comfortable home, you certainly have your options. But making your home feel as good as it looks requires an essential. Ask for Tyvek Home Wrap from DuPont. It helps keep weather out, comfort in. And that's basic to better building.
Welcome back to our opening day triple header here on ESPN. Opening day in the summer of love of 1969. They were the Seattle Pilots. They're now the Milwaukee Brewers. And now they are a National League team. And against Greg Maddux, John Jaha goes the other way. That'll knock in Fernando Vina. Brewers put two aboard, and then former Brave Marquise Grissom struck out to end the third. Back to Dan and Ray.
Gary, thank you. Here are the folks out on the boardwalk by the warehouse of the Brewers. They're having a good time in spite of the fact their team has done absolutely nothing offensively today. Stymied on 2 hits, 46,000 and change waiting to erupt. A lot of funny things have happened in the late innings in this ballpark in the last few years. Mike Mussina the first time through. Got touched up the second time through in the fourth inning when he gave up a two-run single to Larry Sutton. But the third time through, he has been unbelievable. Has retired 5-4 by strikeout. Base hit up the middle for Dean Palmer. Each time time the Royals have had the leadoff man on, they have scored him so far in this game.
Number 22, the Huntfield.
First line of bullpen activity, though. Newcomer Norm Charlton up and throwing.
We'll also see what type of manager Tony Buse is going to be. Here you have your seven-hole hitter, your six-hole hitter leads off with a single. Three-run lead. You always want to get that fourth run on the board. See what he's thinking here. If he's thinking bunt or move the runner with a little hit and run.
Sutton's got a hole to shoot through there on the right side with Palmeiro holding on Palmer. And Sutton with the biggest hit of this game, the two-run single his last time up. Here comes Ripken creeping in. Sutton swings away and drives one to left center field. Anderson looking back to make a one-handed catch.
Seemingly more and more you find managers that don't bunt for that extra run, that fourth run, that fifth run. You know, when I first came along in the game, and even before that, when I observed the game, it was almost automatic. If you get somebody in the bottom of the lineup on the base, that they bunt it and then pinch hit, do whatever you have to do to get that other run. But it's key to get that runner on second base with one out. And but it just seems like there's just La Russa does it and Leland does it, but not too many people do it anymore.
And fewer do it over in this league than do it in the National League. Check on Palmer. Some teams, and Baltimore is an example, you rarely see them doing it because they're a station-to-station team and they've got the short porch and all the power hitters.
Well, you saw Pendleton bunt and pop up early, and one reason why they go away from it is bunting has become really in lost art. It used to be something that everybody could do, and now it seems like no one can do it well. I know the pitchers in the National League are pathetic at getting bunts down, and it's so crucial. It allows you sometimes to get another inning. You bunt the guy over instead of having to be pinch hit for. And there's Ray Miller, who spent the majority of his career in the National League.
I think you could see it in interleague play last year that as bad as the National League pitchers may be, they still had a leg up on the American League pitchers, and they could help themselves in the interleague games. And the number eight hitter in the National League could really help himself, whereas the number eight hitter in the American League is maybe a Chris Hoyle, somebody who might not bunt more than two or three times a year. Got a runner on first, one down. Mike Sweeney, the hitter, he's 0 for 2. Royals already leading 3-0 in the seventh, and Norm Charlton up and working behind Mike Mussina here in this game for the Orioles.
Again, another situation, one and one, one out, eight-hole hitter up. I don't know how well Sutton runs. They say he has average speed, but ideal situation to start the runner and try to get first and third, give Martinez a chance to hit with the infield back, and with his speed, tough to turn a double play. You create runs that way.
Palmer the lead, held by Palmeiro. Again, Mussina taking all kinds of time whenever a runner gets on, whatever base he's at, and finally Sweeney steps out. The Orioles play the longest games in baseball. Up on the right side of the infield, Palmeiro back, move on Alomar to make the catch for the second out. Let's take a look at today's pitching summary brought to you by Outback Steakhouse. Tim Belcher, what a way to get going in the season after a spring ERA of better than 11. And it's not like Mike Mussina has been bad just against Belcher. Today, so far, he hasn't been quite good enough.
Yeah, you better be careful about spring training pitching with veterans. You can read a lot into that, and hitters as well. But veteran pitchers going down there, get their legs in shape, trying to get the rhythm, build a pitch count up, and then come opening day, let it rip. And Belcher's been around so long that he knows that. There's no reason to waste energy. All of his work is done. He doesn't care. He's just trying to feel his breaking ball, get a good feel of his changeup, and get his rhythm. I see it happen time and time again, spring training after spring training.
Third opening day start for Belcher as Felix Martinez stands in. Ground out and a strikeout today. Runner at first, two down, seventh inning. The three-game series between these two. Then when the Royals open up at home early next week, Baltimore will provide the opposition. Opened up the gates 3 hours before first pitch here today at Camden Yards. Quite a few fans came in early to watch batting practice. See Ripken in on the grass in case Martinez drops one down. Runner goes. Throw bounces in and a stolen base for Dean Palmer. The Royals taking advantage of Chris Hoyles, who at least statistically last year was one of the worst in baseball throwing runners out.
Well, that's one reason I thought something might happen. You know, he only threw out, 21% of the runners last year. But that shows you the philosophy right now. Mussa already has a philosophy. He's not going to run himself out of innings. When you get two outs, you'll take a shot and let the nine-hole hitter lead off the next inning. Now a blooper or anything, but he just didn't want to do anything until there were two outs. He didn't want to run out of a big inning.
And a count 1-1. Big swing by Martinez, and that's probably a swing that Mussa doesn't like to see. For a number nine hitter who doesn't have any power, he's got a bit of a long swing at this point.
Well, he does have a long swing, and I've only heard things about his defensive play, especially his throwing arm. He had a gun. Had a little trouble with his hands, but outstanding throwing arm, not much with the bat.
And he's gone. Mussina strikes him out. Mike Messina's 10th strikeout of the game, and the Royals strand a runner.
Critics are calling My Giant a winner.
Good morning.
Enormously entertaining and surprisingly powerful, Billy Crystal shines in a sweet comedy that's all heart.
I could put you in the movies.
Brilliantly acted, written, and directed, My Giant is the biggest comedy to come along in years.
You are my friend.
Billy Crystal, Kathleen Quinlan, and George Mirasan. My Giant, rated PG, at theaters Friday, April 10th.
Delta, British Airways, Northwest, KLM, United. All of these, in fact, most of the world's major airlines, domestic and international, rely on this oil company for fuel. When it really counts, they seem to be the one to count on. With that in mind, what kind of gasoline do you think they'd make for your car? You'd be right. Citgo, when it counts.
Who always greets you warmly and asks so little in return?
The folks at Red Roof Inn. It's a genuine smile, a clean, comfortable room, and a great rate. Dogs have no concept of money, no pockets. Red Roof Inn's nice people and an honest value.
Demanded better training facilities. Insisted on new uniforms and equipment. Held out for hundreds of free tickets. These guys will stop at nothing to get whatever they can for the Boys and Girls Clubs of America. Major League Baseball charities and the Boys and Girls Clubs of America, giving kids a world of opportunities.
Update from Miami, the home of the world champions, Gary Sheffield, with two aboard, rocks one off Kevin Tappany. Ryan Jackson, the new first baseman, had already knocked in a run. That three-run blast to the upper deck gives the Marlins a 4-3 lead in the Cubs.
That's about the only guy they couldn't trade. They got rid of so many players, but because of Sheffield's contract, he's got a no-trade clause. He's staying put, it looks like. Capable of big things if he's healthy. Here the Orioles trying to get on the board. Just a couple of singles through six innings against a very tough Tim Belcher. Seven-inning stretches seem to wake up the fans a little bit here at Camden Yards as they're up and clapping a little bit, trying to find something to get excited about. And a good part of the order coming up, Alomar, Eric Davis, Rafael Palmeiro. Alomar with his highest batting average ever last season, despite the injuries, at .333. But obviously much more effective this year if he can swing the bat both ways, as apparently he can. Speaking of switch hitters.
Well, I didn't didn't see much of Mickey Mantle. I saw a lot of Ted Simmons and Reggie Smith, but when I got to play with Eddie Murray, there's no question that he was the best switch hitter I ever played with or saw.
1-2 to Alomar. He's up and away. Amazing for, to be so consistent and have so much power from one side.
I forgot about Pete Rose.
How could you forget about Pete Rose?
I forgot about Pete Rose. But as far as power and being able to drive the baseball, none better than him.
Mm-hmm. Upstairs again in a full count. Some activity now in the Kansas City pen. Last year's starter and last year's all-star for Kansas City, Jose Rosado, coming off some knee surgery, relegated to bullpen duty here at the beginning of this year.
Well, Bob Boone told me in spring training last year that Rosado had the best arm of anybody on his staff.
And a drive to left. Sutton still going back and makes a leaping catch on the track. One down.
Boy, that ball is carrying out there today.
It does seem to be. Hasn't done the Orioles a whole lot of good. As you can see, just two little base hits, singles by Davis and Palmeira. Tim Belcher hasn't even walked anybody so far today.
He hasn't had many 3-2 counts. That may have been the first 3-2 count. I know he hasn't had many.
One down, and here's Eric Davis, who owns one of those two base hits. Lays off inside.
Now watch Belcher now, Danny. What he'll start doing, if he start getting tired, the fastball is going to start to get up. His breaking ball will be short. Start throwing his breaking ball that will bounce, and his fastball will start riding up in the strike zone. Like that. Ball's just a little high for Eric Davis. If you're going to get Eric Davis out on fastballs, you throw him right about that Oriole, right underneath the Oriole, and you get the ball in on him. If you get it out there away from him where his bat barrel is, he'll hammer that ball to right center field. And as I said earlier in our telecast, he's a much better high fastball hitter now late in his career than he was early in his career.
How has he become a better high fastball hitter when you assume that his bat speed has slowed down?
I think that he lays, there's an area there right under that Oriole. If you get above that stripe there, he's not going to do much with it. I think he's learned to lay off that pitch. And it's very difficult to make that pitch there consistently. Pitchers are afraid to make it because if you miss by an inch or two, somebody hits a bomb.
Right.
He had a tendency to chase that ball just up above his chest, right on up to his neck, and he couldn't do anything with it. And Reggie Sanders is going through the same thing like that. He was exposed in 95 with the Braves staff when they just elevated with him with the fastball up. And I think Eric Davis has learned to not swing that pitch up there.
Davis grounds one down to third. Palmer with a long throw and a high throw over the head of Morris. Davis is safe at first. We got a little baseball history happening here. Let's go to Gary Miller.
That's right, Dan. At the new Tropicana Field has been named a couple of things. Tampa Bay finally has its own team. We bring you the opening pitch for Wilson Alvarez against the Detroit Tigers. Brian Hunter, we go to our old friend Dwayne Statz in St. Pete.
A wild pitch allowed one of those guys to reach. So Wilson Alvarez will face the Detroit Tigers here this afternoon in game one of Double A history. Larry Rothschild, open camp with over 70 players. Got it down to 25 in the days just before they opened those three exhibition games here at Tropicana Field to try to give his club a few days together. It will take perhaps a few more days before they become a cohesive unit. A full house. And the first pitch in Devil Rays history just moments away. Richie Garcia will be calling the balls and strikes. Mark Riley first, Tim McClellan at second, and John Hirschbeck will be the umpire down the third base side. Fans anticipating this moment. For years they've been anticipating this moment. Tampa Bay, a long and storied baseball tradition dating back to the early part of this century when they were the host of the Boys of Spring. Now they're the host of the Boys of Summer. And the first pitch in Double Ray history. Down and in, ball one, and that will go directly to the Hall of Fame. So Wilson Alvarez facing Brian Hunter. And Tampa Bay is in the major leagues. Hunter, young outfielder, atop this lineup for Buddy Bell. And Alvarez throws him a strike. Joe, you know, big butterflies for Wilson Alvarez.
He's a low-key guy, but trust me, he's got some anxious butterflies going today.
Hunter fouls this one back, a ball and two strikes. Not only is the opening day pitcher an honor, and Alvarez has that honor today, but he's opening the history of the franchise, and he has his mother and father here. They had seen him pitch one other game in the major leagues, and they're in to see him pitch this game against Detroit. And on the first base, Fred McGriff, Tampa's own, makes the play unassisted.
All right, so there's the very first play in Tampa Bay Devil Rays history. We'll keep you up with all the firsts there. Right now, back to Camden Yards.
Gary, thank you. And again, the first game in Arizona Diamondbacks history will be on ESPN tonight. It's the third game of the triple-header. While you were witnessing the goings-on in Tampa Bay, Rafael Palmeiro struck out for the second out of the seventh inning here in Baltimore. Eric Davis is at first and now on the go. Throw down. And after a long look at it, Jim Joyce is going to punch out Eric Davis and punch out the Orioles in the seventh inning. A strong throw by Mike Sweeney to get him. And Tim Belcher's shutout bid continues. Seven great innings for him. A little help from his catcher as well.
Unpredictable.
Simona! Paolo è il gioiello di un'altra donna! Lo sapevo!
Sometimes you need health insurance.
Paolo, sei un uomo!
Sometimes you need life insurance. And sometimes...
Paolo!
Simone, è per te.
You need investments for the future. So at the Consigo Companies, our goal is to help you protect wealth, create wealth for life.
Here at hole 7 of the Cooper Tire Invitational, a long par 9,000 from Chicago, the green surrounded by water. We talked to our leader about this crucial hole.
Tough hole. I rely a lot on my Cooper tires and my low iron.
Here's some replays of you through the Midwest.
Had a few nice shots here in Missouri.
And then that impressive run down the Gulf Coast. We're live in the Everglades. Ernie lying 8,003.
The world is your course. Drive on.
ESPN's opening day special is brought to you by BMW, the ultimate driving machine. By Conseco, where our goal is to help you protect wealth, create wealth for life. By Cooper Tire Rubber Company. Cooper Tire, the world is your course. Drive on. And by Nike. And we are back here in Baltimore. This game in the top of the eighth inning with Kansas City still leading 3-0. That has been the score since the fourth. And the top of the order up for the Royals, center fielder Johnny Damon. He'll be followed by Jose Offerman and then Hal Morris. Mike Mussina still on the mound for Baltimore here into the eighth. Tim Belcher appears to be done. Get a round of handshakes on his way into the dugout. And what a way to start the season.
Boy, man, 95 pitches, outstanding job, tremendous control against a great hitting ball club that he shut down.
Mussina covering, takes the toss from Palmeiro, and Damon is retired. Remember, with Kevin Apier out for at least 3 months, Tim Belcher becomes the ace by default on this Kansas City staff, and Tony Muser needs him to lead the way.
Well, Timmy won 15 games, starting with the Dodgers, and then he went to 115 with the Reds, and three times won 15 ball games. Won 15 games year before last with Kansas City.
There's Jose Offerman, 0-3, a couple of strikeouts. two of the 10 strikeouts Mike Mussina has on the afternoon. And great pitch on the outside corner with an ease. Kansas City is probably going to be in a lot of games like this year. Baltimore might find themselves in a few more slugfests, but the Royals just don't have the firepower to win the 8-7 games. They better win these ones.
Yeah, I don't see them in a lot of games like this. I see them more like 11-2.
Mussina out in front of Offerman, 0-2. And finally steps out. Look at the bullpens here that are very visible to the fans out in left center. Jim Pitsley, big right-hander, is up for Kansas City. Charlton, and I believe that was Terry Matthews down below, throwing for Baltimore.
Yeah, Pitsley actually started last year for that ball club and struggled a lot. Great fastball, and now they put him in the bullpen to set up and actually told me middle, long setup, whatever they needed. They think he has a very resilient arm, but real strong, hard throw.
Came up about 2 years ago as a very highly thought of pitching prospect. About the same time Johnny Damon was coming up as a center fielder, but he's had a lot of injuries and really hasn't been able to make any progress. Down there in the bullpen along with Rosano, another starter turned reliever here for Tony Muser. Outside and a full count on a Jose Offerman after Mussina had him 0-2. Ground ball out to second, charged by Alomar. A fine play in plenty of time to get Offerman. Two down.
Next up is the first baseman, number 23, Al Morris.
Orioles hoping that an Alomar return to health not only gets him running a little bit more, but gets him back to being undisputably the best defensive second baseman in baseball. He seemed to be lacking half a step and lacking a little bit of that Alomar flair last year.
Well, when you're hurting, it's really tough. I played half of my career hurt, and I didn't have a whole lot of great athletic tools. But you're talking Roberto Alomar, the best defensive second baseman has come along in 10 years range-wise, can make any play, turns a double play as well as anybody, could steal 60 or 70 bases if he would. And again, right and left-handed, a very dangerous hitter. For a guy as small as stature, outstanding power. I'm talking about gap power and 15, 18 home runs. So he's just an elite player that injuries have slowed him down.
11th year in the major leagues, and Roberto Alomar is still just 30 years of age, and that makes him the youngest position player out there today for the Baltimore Orioles. But at 30, and he's a free agent at the end of the year, he's got a long ways to go. And he's one of these guys like a Robin Yount who started playing so much so young, put up huge career numbers at a young age, and he seems destined to be a 3,000 hit guy and a Hall of Fame guy when it's all said and done.
If he stays healthy, I don't see any reason why he can't. He should be able to play another 6 or 7 years, and he's averaged 170 hits plus a year, so you're talking another, you know, what's that? Add up math, please.
A lot.
A lot.
He should have easily another 1,200 hits in his future. Hal Morris upset he didn't pick one up here. Another fine inning for Mussina, but the outs are running out on the Orioles.
Mounting that camera inside a baseball wasn't the best way to get a close-up of Larry Walker's batting gloves. Franklin Carbon Fiber Batting Gloves. The official batting glove of Major League Baseball.
Moscow, we have a problem.
Guys like me don't get much respect. I mean, I hit big, but there's no D-order commercial. I make huge plays. I'm not even in a cereal box, but man, I could care less.
Triple Play 99. You've never seen baseball like this.
Who needs cereal?
Whoa. EA Sports. It's in the game.
Here's something you should never do with your eyeglasses unless they're made from Flexon. Even after bending and twisting, Flexon frames still look and fit great. Feel free to fall asleep in your glasses. Feel free to squeeze your Flexon frames. Feel free to kid around. Flexon frames. Durable, comfortable, light. Ask for them by name. Flexon by Marshawn.
Beauty. Adventure. Drama. All these and more can be yours in the wonderful world of art. And with this free art test from Art Instruction Schools, you can find out if you have the interest and desire needed to become a serious art student. To get your free art test without cost or obligation, call this toll-free number. Don't delay. Call this toll-free number now. Call 1-800-633-3400.
Welcome back to Baltimore. Bottom of the eighth inning and time now for the Nike game summary. It has been a well-pitched game, especially by Tim Belcher, who didn't walk anybody in his seven innings in there. The Royals' heart of the order has done the damage on Mike Mussina. There hasn't been much damage, as you can see, with the 11 strikeouts, but the 3-4-5 hitters, Morris, King, and Pendleton, responsible for the Kansas City offense as the Royals try to beat the Orioles here on opening day. Into the bullpen we go for the first time in this game. Left-hander Jose Rosado, again a starter last year and the Royals' all-star representative a year ago. Better than 200 innings, comes on here to face Ripken, Surhoff, and Carter in the bottom of the eighth.
Well, he had a great first half, winning seven games in the first half, and after that, just really struggling. Really good fastball that moves hard away from right-handed hitters, telling fastball, slurvish-type breaking ball, and a changeup that just dies.
Thinking back to watching him last year, unusually poised, too, for a guy his age. He showed no nervousness out there on the mound at all. Wasn't afraid to use all his pitches. Ripken 0 for 2. First time up, struck out looking, and had some words for Jim McKean. Second time up, fouled back. Fouled out to the catcher. This time he skies one into shallow left field. Martinez out and Sutton in. One down.
Well, it's interesting that Tony Muser makes this move. You got a left-handed pitcher out there facing a right-handed batter, left-handed right. So he... just going to show how he's going to go through the season. He's already picking Rosado as the setup man, and no matter who's going to hit, because you got four out of five hitters right-handed, and he brings in the left-hander.
Here's B.J. Surhoff, the one left-handed hitter, and he hits lefties awfully well. Slightly open stance, gets a good look at the ball as he looks it all the way into the mitt for strike one. Belcher, seven innings, three hits, no runs, no walks, six strikeouts. And all going well for Kansas City, we'll see Jeff Montgomery in the ninth inning. One-on-one is a breaking ball down and in. Seen Jeff Montgomery a little bit earlier. Also, Scott Servais is up. Maybe we'll see Servais come in after Surhoff to face the one right here this inning, and then Montgomery in the ninth. Who knows how Tony Muser's going to play?
Well, I was
going
to say Scott Servais, another one of those players that I manage, but I think everybody's managed Scott Servais. He has one time to traded three times in 1 year.
Yeah. And two, the count on Surhoff. And down and away, it's full. BJ today sent into a double play and flied out to center field. On deck, Joe Carter. And a ground ball pulled out to second. No problem for offering. And two quick outs for Jose Rosado. Is announced, and no sign of any change from the Kansas City bullpen. Rosado cruising along will stay. Now the only changes that are being made are defensive ones in terms of positioning. The Royals, who are unfamiliar with Carter, are trying to get a good sense of where to play him. center field here at Camden Yards as Carter does what he does best. Laces one down the left field line and on his way to second with his first hit as a Baltimore Oriole. Let's go back to the studio and get an update with Gary Miller.
Dan, the first two games of 1998 are in the books. Don Winger now in relief of Kevin Brown, who won his Padres debut. Dimitri Young will be robbed by James Mouton, who goes back, comes in. What a disaster for the Reds. They scored 10 on him and lose it 10-2. Four errors by Pokey Reese ties an opening day record for shortstops. And the White Sox, look out for this offense. They win it 9-2. Nice grab by Mike Cameron as they wipe out Texas.
Mike Cameron and Maglio Ordonez, some good gun players, making their way into the White Sox lineup. Here, one of the veterans getting his first hit in an unfamiliar uniform.
And again, that breaking ball away, and or the fastball turned over away, and is able to rake it down on left field line with that great plate coverage.
A double for Carter. The first time all day the Orioles have had a runner in scoring position. Hoyles to try to knock him in and break the goose egg against the Royals, running out of time with two outs in the eighth.
Get a little deeper in the thought process with the left-hander on the mound. If they bring the right-hander in to face Bordick, you have Harold Baines over there, but you certainly have Guillen, who can play shortstop with anybody, and that gives great flexibility now to Ray Miller. So I would say that the deck is stacked for Ray Miller because he has an answer to anybody they bring in from bullpen.
Tremendous bench with Baines and Guillen and Jeffrey Hammonds. And guys in Lenny Webster and Jeff Rebele, who did a lot of good for the Orioles. With Alomar and Hoyles battling injuries last year, Rebele and Webster had to step it up a little bit. Webster there in the center of your screen. 1-1 to Hoyles. 3-0 Kansas City. Tails up and in. Two balls in the strike. Bordick on deck. And the 2-1 to Hoyles. Ripped down the left field line. Fair. And into the seats for a ground rule double as Carter scores, and it's 3-1.
We're going to see here another right-handed hitter, as we mentioned at the beginning of this inning. Fastball out away from him. He rips it down the left field line. Just fair bounces up. Foul. Fair bounces out of play. But this is what happens when you're short on a bullpen. You end up facing right-handed hitters with left-handed pitchers, and usually bad things happen.
And the moves and the counter moves. Jeffrey Hammonds was just announced as a pinch hitter for Mike Bordick. And that brought Tony Muser to the mound. He is going to pull Jose Rosado.
And that will send Hammonds to the bench and bring on Harold Baines.
So a little bit of chess here between a Muser and a Miller in the eighth inning, with the lead suddenly looking a little more tenuous for the Royals at 3-1.
Texas. Do you need a dependable car? Then call this number right now. If you have a job, a down payment, AmeriCars will get you financed. Work cars, work trucks, even sport utilities and sports cars. If AmeriCars can't get you financed, we'll give you the car. That's right. If you have a job, regardless of your credit, good, bad, or no, if AmeriCars can't get you financed, we'll give you the car. Find out what hundreds of South Texans already know. AmeriCars can get you financed. Call the number right now.
The San Antonio chapter of the Susan G. Komen Breast Cancer Foundation is proud to host the first annual Race for the Cure, and I am privileged to be one of the honorary co-chairs for this year's premier race against breast cancer. Until there's a cure for breast cancer, the race is not won. Please join us Saturday, April 4th, 8 a.m. at Alamo Stadium for San Antonio's first annual Race for the Cure. As you walk, jog, run, and cheer for the fight against breast cancer, go by any of the participating sponsored locations to pick up a race application. San Antonio's Race for the Cure. Every step is about putting an end to breast cancer.
Homeowners in need of a home equity loan. It's time you called Superior Bank FSB to get the Superior difference. Superior Bank is a federal savings bank which for over 75 years has been helping homeowners save money by refinancing at lower rates, consolidate their high interest debt, or pay off overdue credit cards. Superior has helped thousands of homeowners who were rejected elsewhere or who have had credit problems in the past.
Homeowners, call Superior Direct at 1-888-678-7777 and get the Superior difference.
New Oriole Joe Carter got it going with a double. Chris Hoyles drove him in with a ground rule double. And then here come the moves, which have resulted in right-hander Scott Service coming on for the Kansas City Royals.
Well, Scotty Service, I've seen him pitch now for the last 6 years. Got a little herky-jerky motion, slings the ball, big slurvish-type pitch. The ball will break all the way across the plate. Sinker down and in to right-handed hitters. He better watch out right here because Hal Baines hitting, likes the ball out away from him. Very, very tough to pitch to. Great eye. Scotty Service has never had real good success against left-handed hitters. And that's always been his problem. He's always gotten right-handed hitters out extremely well, but that's what happens when you have a lot of bullets over there. Ray Miller certainly has some bullets.
Baines coming on as a pinch hitter for Jeffrey Hammonds, who was announced for Mike Bordick. So Hammonds out of the game. Last year's number for Harold Baines. He is expected to get a lot of the DH work. Joe Carter in there in place of Baines because of very good career numbers against Tim Belcher. But at the moment, Harold Baines represents the game's tying run.
Scott Service won't throw the ball by you. He throws about 76 on his changeup to about 84 on his fastball. His 83-mile-an-hour fastball. He has real good late movement, but he really, left-handers seem to seam really well because when he drops down out there, they see the ball so long, doesn't have anything to really hide the ball with.
He's got to know that in this situation, in this ballpark, all Harold Baines is thinking about is that scoreboard out in right field.
Or left center, knowing Harold Baines, he likes that ball out away from him, and he'll hit the fastball to left center and then hit that scoreboard, like you said, on the breaking ball.
Wind has picked up a little bit, blowing out to left center. The temperature's really started to drop here in the last little while. Good cut by Baines, and it's 1-2. It was 90 degrees when the game began at 3 Eastern. Record temperatures for this time of the year here in Baltimore.
Scott Service, a lot like the ex-Astro Mark Grant. Really funny. Type of guy that has bounced around but loves the game of baseball and loves to be on the mound.
And he got Baines. He was brought in to get one guy, and he got him. The Royals still lead 3-1 through 8.
When sports cream, when legs are sore, when backs ache, when muscles hurt, why sports cream? Rubbing it in brings fast pain relief. No medicine-y smell. Why sports cream? Because it works.
Got a few minutes to spare? New Turtle Wax Express Shine can quickly make your car look showroom new. Just spray on and wipe off. Turtle Wax Express Shine is carnauba enriched for a brilliant glow and long-lasting protection. And it works for all finishes, including clear coats. So try new Turtle Wax Express Shine and get a great Turtle Wax Shine in just minutes. And come down hard on grease with new Turtle Wax Purple Muscle Heavy Duty Cleaner.
Zero pressure Michelin. So revolutionary it won't go flat, even with the puncture the size of a golf ball, letting you drive up to 50 miles at 55 miles per hour. Just what you'd expect from Michelin.
The knife was stone. It was a knife of mythic proportions. And no one could resist the pull of the knife. And then one day came the answer. It takes a big, juicy Outback steak to unlock the true potential of the legendary Outback steak knife.
Just what I was looking for.
Outback Steakhouse. No rules, just right.
Now, if I could only find the fork in the road.
A magazine's success starts with the writers.
Get me the lowdown on Jordan. What's this beef with the Bulls? And give me a piece on the Latin influence on baseball. Pedro Martinez, Omar Vizquel, with a preview on all 30 clubs. Comprende? Print it, baby!
Now the Orioles get a one run on the board in the bottom of the eighth. night that has woken up the fans a little bit. Sellout crowd here on opening day. Got to inspire the troops here heading to the ninth. Well, ESPN's exclusive opening day coverage continues with the Indians taking on the Seattle Mariners at 7 Eastern tonight. Randy Johnson and Charles Nagy, the pitching matchup there. And then later on tonight, Colorado at Arizona, the Diamondbacks debut. Daryl Kyle for the Rockies, Andy Bennis for the Diamondbacks. And a new pitcher here, and new to Baltimore as well, Norm Charlton.
Yeah, Norm Charlton coming off of a horrible year over there with the Mariners, but still one of those guys that you like to give the ball to. Fastball and cutter, little changeup. I used to throw the ball about 100 miles an hour when he was a member of that Nasty Boys crew.
This is Ernie Young here to begin the ninth inning, and Young sends a fly ball fairly deep back in right field. Eric Davis, as he crashes down on the track, hangs on. A little adventure out of that, but records it for the out as we send you back to Gary Miller.
And the Tropicana field, Wilson Alvarez on the mound against Joe Randa. Goes down and gets it. Randa, who's been in a couple of trades, knocks in Clark and Easley. Joe Oliver followed with a two-run single. It's 4-0, Tigers over Tampa.
Gary, Eric Davis back up, checking himself for damage. Got a big round of applause, making a circus catch out there, Ray.
Well, you don't see, he got turned wrong a little bit, and then he just stumbles just as the grass and the AstroTurf come together there and causes him to fall. But he's as good an outfielder as I've seen and made a great transition to right field last year.
Terry Pendleton, the batter. And again, Eric Davis has spoken about this often. He doesn't want to be known as a player who has recovered from cancer. He wants to be known as a baseball player, just like everybody else. Doesn't view himself as heroic in any way. Pendleton with a chopper left side. Ripken. Two down, and more news from Gary.
Dan, earlier in the day, we showed you Mark McGwire striking out against Ramon Martinez. This time, Mighty Mac. Opening day home run.
Going back on the ball.
And that ball is kissed. So McGwire, who had 24 home runs in his 2 months with St. Louis, gives St. Louis a 4-0 lead and hitting it into Big Mac land. Back to you.
Well, it's an expansion year, Ray. That means home runs go up. Does the record fall this year?
Well, if it is going to fall, it's going to be here, Griffey. And with that ballpark now becoming a much smaller park, it just seems to play smaller. And the way that Mac has been swinging the bat healthy the last 2 years, I wouldn't doubt that it would fall.
Two down, Dean Palmer, the batter. Royals leading 3-1. I wonder if Juan Gonzalez can stay healthy, if he can.
Oh, mercy, yeah. No question about it. No question about it. I mean, I just read a stat I wasn't aware of the other day where Mac had hit 70 home runs in his last 162 games. So they just spread out over 2 years.
Dean Palmer today, 1-for-3, has singled, stolen a base, and also drove in a run on a ground ball, the first run of the year for the Royals. They lead 3-1. Ozzie Guillen making his Oriole debut, coming on to play shortstop here in the ninth inning after 13 years with the White Sox. And he might give a bit of a spark to what traditionally has been one of the quieter clubhouses in baseball.
Well, he does love to talk, but it's always something positive. And never met a stranger. Played the game with flair. Still plays the game with flair. But before he broke his ankle, one of the truly great, great shortstops. And usually what sets great shortstops aside is range, and he has had as much range as anyone.
Now this one is just by him into left field. A sharp single for Palmer, his second hit of the day.
See, Danny, that's the difference between an Ozzie Guillen when he was young and an Ozzie Guillen now. You get a first-step quickness and enables you to get to the ball. The ball's hit sharply, but that first step allows you to get there. And see, he dives just a half a step. And when you get older, you lose a good step. And as a shortstop that's broken his leg, he's probably a step and a half shorter laterally than he was 5 or 6 years ago.
And he's not in Baltimore just to play shortstop. They have used him at short, second, first, and left field in the spring. He knew when he signed, if he was going to make the team, it would be as the 25th guy, the utility player. There's Larry Sutton, swinging a miss.
I have tremendous respect for guys like Norm Charlton. I first saw him in Cincinnati in the early 90s, and here's a guy that, if there ever was a power pitcher that just came at you, he, Dibble, Randy Myers, he came at you with nothing but juice, boy. And last year, he had a horrible year. He's become an off-speed, changeup type pitcher, but he's still out there trying.
288, that's not too bad. But I've never seen, when they talk about the Nasty Boys, I never saw ever in my career, 25 years covering baseball, three arms that good out of the bullpen back to back to back.
And down to second base on the play without a throw goes Dean Palmer. Slung quite a pace for himself with two steals in the first game of the season, a guy who doesn't run very much. As many as he had all of last year. 1-2, the count on Sutton. He's already driven in a couple here today. And ropes one to right center field. This is well hit and in the gap and over the wall on a bounce. A ground rule double for Sutton. A three RBI day and a 4-1 Kansas City lead.
Norm Charlton paid to get left-handers out. Sutton already driven in two runs earlier. Fastball right down the middle, down low, though. Left-handed hitters love that ball down low. Watch this pitch come right in there. Little bit of sinkage. That may have been a breaking ball. That ball looked like more of a breaking ball. It came kind of at him and went down. I thought it was a sinker at first. Got to get those left-handed hitters out. But as we see Charlton lead.
New pitcher on the way in. A rough Oriole debut for Norm Charlton as the Royals' lead is back to three.
When it comes to renting a car, there's really only one place to go. National Car Rental, the official car rental company of ESPN. So what are you waiting for? Let's go!
Let's go!
On April 3rd, a code will be broken.
Impossible.
A child will be threatened.
There must be nothing that connects the boy to this office.
And one man must stand alone.
A 9-year-old cracked the government's super code?
Against the power that is meant to protect us all.
This is national security.
Put your head down!
From the producer of Apollo 13 and Ransom.
Get down!
Bruce Willis.
No!
Mercury Rising, rated R.
Starts Friday at theaters everywhere.
You see coffee. At Sprint, we see data. Data from the field that works to project the future and allows access to information that helps people work together to achieve results on a global scale. A rich, robust blend of data that business relies on every day. Because business runs on data, and data runs on Sprint.
A snowflake falls at the far end of history. And that snowflake, we'll call him Steve, winds up as part of a droplet of water. And one day, that droplet, Steve's droplet, could wind up in a brewery where a man you'll never meet discovers the perfect temperature to cross-brew beer. And like that, Steve is in a Coors Light can, and then a tray, and a cup. And now, he's here with you. So I ask you, gentle stranger, do not spill, Steve. Coors Light!
And back in Baltimore, the Royals now up 4-1 on the Orioles. Larry Sutton with three RBIs on the day. He knocks Norm Charlton out of the game, and that brings on right-hander Alan Mills here in the top of the ninth inning.
Yeah, Mills, fastball slider, slur, changeup. Pretty hard thrower. Part of that bullpen last year that made Davey Johnson look as brilliant as he really is.
He walks awfully high for Alan Mills. He has battled injuries each of the last 3 years. It's really a one-batter situation for him. The man of the afternoon, unquestionably, is Larry Sutton. A single, a double, and three driven in out in right field because of injuries to the outfield for the Royals, and he can't play first base. Jeff King is there, but even when everybody gets healthy, Tony Muser may have to find a spot for this guy the way he's swinging the bat today. The catcher, Mike Sweeney, 0 for 3. Pulls one down to third. Ripken to a knee. And the inning is over. But not before the Royals get one back and take a 4-1 lead with the Orioles coming up in the bottom of the ninth.
Thank you.
jockey. Great underwear.
Let them know you're jockey.
Your money. Investing it should get you somewhere. So you put your money in mutual funds. How do they invest it? At Janus, they dig deep. They like to visit the company before they buy the stock. They interview customers, suppliers, employees. Looking that closely turns up the most promising places to invest your money. That's how you get there. Janus No Load Mutual Funds.
Tired of carrying all that heavy water around every time you vacuum the wet basement? Get the new ShopVac QPV, the quiet vacuum that sucks water from one place and pumps it to another. Because you've got better things to do than lug water around. ShopVac, the only thing more powerful is our name.
Back in Baltimore, the Orioles three runs down with three outs to go. Kansas City, on the strength of three RBIs by Larry Sutton, leads Baltimore 4-1 here on opening day. Coming up behind us, SportsCenter. Larry Beal and Bob Stevens are going to take you around the major leagues. Also, Vin Baker against his old mates. And a recap of the final four from down in San Antonio, Kentucky. A nine-pointer winner over Utah last night. Here is the Kansas City closer for so many years, Jeff Montgomery.
What a story Jeff Montgomery is. Last year, coming off a shoulder surgery, probably was rushed a little bit, wasn't really ready, made the Royals opening roster, opening day roster, coming out of spring training. Had a 20.25 earned run average in April after giving up five runs in one inning early on, and really settled down, got 14 saves with a 3.49 earned run average in his last 59 points. Fastball, big, hard breaking ball.
12th on the all-time save list with 256. He's going to face the top of the Oriole order, Brady Anderson, Roberto Alomar, and Eric Davis. And Brady lays off. Montgomery's first appearance last year with Kansas City and Baltimore seemingly facing each other on opening day every year was on the second day of the season against Baltimore. He gave up three runs and needed to save, so he does not have fond memories of this ballpark or the Orioles from early last season. What a difference a break makes.
Oh, man.
Was over in Cincinnati and was a starting pitcher at the time, came over to the Royals in a minor deal and developed into one of the best closers around. He used to be able to go a lot of innings. Little squibber by Anderson. Montgomery used to be one of these horse closers, 2-3 innings if you needed them, but as the wear and tear has built up on his arm, he's become a one inning closer like all the other guys. Anderson retired, and Roberto Alomar is going to come to the plate. Things looked a lot different for Baltimore when they got it to 3-1, but that one run by the Royals in the top of the ninth has given this inning a much different complexion. Breaking ball for a strike.
Montgomery, a lot like Jeff Brantley, I manage with the Reds now with the Cardinals, has ability to throw the fastball for a strike. Doesn't intimidate you with size or overpowering stuff, but somehow has that will in his heart and that ability to make pitches when he has to, and just comes right at you relentlessly, time and time again, right at you, 0-2, 0-2, and then makes a pitch.
And that's what he did there. Alomar fought it off out of play. He's one of the few guys, Montgomery, who has been able to sustain himself as a closer over a number of years. You talked about the Nasty Boys pen. Rob Dibble looked like he would be one of the best, and he just blew up and isn't even pitching anymore. But along with a John Franco, Randy Myers, of course, Dennis Eckersley longer than any of them.
Lee Smith.
Mm-hmm. Alomar with a fly ball, shallow right. Running Young in after a bit of a late start, and the Royals are an out away. Tony Mugler on the verge of win number one here this season.
you'd be amazed at what you could do by playing the game right. Last year, Pittsburgh, with minimal salary and minimal talent. I mean, they had a lot of young talent. They certainly didn't have the talent comparable to other ball clubs. Because they played the game correctly, they won a lot of ball games. And Tony Muser, as you mentioned, a former Marine, I've known him for a long time, believes in discipline. And this club can play solid baseball if they just play correct.
1-1 the count on Eric Davis. Last chance here for the Orioles in the bottom of the ninth. Davis with two of Baltimore's five hits on the afternoon. Big cut there, and it's 1-2. Orioles down to their final strike. Outstanding performance by Tim Belcher. Some good work in relief. Big hit by Larry Sutton. Starting to file out a little bit here at Camden Yards. Trying to beat the rush home. Inside corner, Davis is gone, and the Royals beat Baltimore 4-1. Some very impressive pitching here for opening day.
Oh, Tim Belcher just he answered the bell without Apier and came out there and threw it as well as anybody can throw. Montgomery built real positive. The young players. Sutton got a couple base hits, drove in three runs. So a great debut for Tony Muser, opening day, his first opening day.
Ray Miller falls to 0-1 as new manager of the Orioles. His starter, Mike Mussina, pitched pretty well. 11 strikeouts in this game. Boy, he had that outside corner working early. But young Larry Sutton with a couple of big hits to drive in three, and the Royals win by a score of 4-1. Up next, it's SportsCenter with Larry Beal and Bob Stevens. For Ray Knight, I'm Dan Schulman. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Kansas City beats Baltimore 4-1 on opening day.